We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to take the law, we enforce it. But at the end of the day, each and every man has to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back live from Las Vegas. Actually, in the past 2 weeks, this is really just the second show. I did do a show last Tuesday. The week before, I was in Orlando for my paying job, because without that, I couldn't be doing this show and pay my monthly fees to bring the show to you. So thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weekdays, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. You can listen on Spreaker and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com live. We promote, well, live and to the archives. We promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning being able to do what you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, as well as exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force. As all governments are based on power, control, and ruling over others, and achieve this through violence and force. It feels weird. It honestly feels like I haven't done the show in like months, and it's only been... it's really only been a week, like I said, but I mean, I've only done the show, I guess, once in the past 2 weeks. And it's funny because I get like all these ideas and things I want to talk about. And I've started to either with my phone or just, you know, Microsoft Word or whatever, as I think of things, you know, jot them down and make sure that I address them at some point. And there were so many things that had happened the week that I was in Orlando, and I kind of mentioned this last week and talked a little about it last Tuesday, where you had stuff going on in Baltimore. You had what was supposedly, quote unquote, a terrorist attack in Texas. I don't know that that's what I would consider it. But what was even more disturbing was everything surrounding that and how the media is totally trying to exploit that, because where I was at in a hotel room, I didn't get a lot of the same, you know, channels I usually get. And basically, if I watch anything on TV, it's like movies as opposed to government media. So there was just so much stuff that had really bothered me. And again, I talked a little about it last Tuesday, but we have a good show for you on our, I guess, first show back. Ken Schortgen, who joins us once a month of the Daily Economist, will be joining us to talk about geopolitics and the economy and some things going on there. Of course, the currency issue keeps coming up, and we'll talk a little about that, as well as some things going on with Jade Helm, among other things. Before I bring Ken on, I did want to mention one thing briefly this morning. Occasionally, don't ask me why, I'll turn on Glenn Beck just because it's really the only thing in the morning when I'm driving to work that I can get in my car. I can get serious like on my cell phone if I hook it up, but in the morning I'm kind of tired and I just don't really care enough to do that. And, you know, they had somebody on who was just talking about all the issues in the country, of course, and how do we fix this and how do we fix that? And it's funny because it's always the same shit. It's not the same what can be done, but how to accomplish what they want to accomplish. So it's like, okay, well, we want to, you know, first we need to do this. And then we need to pass a law that does this. And then, but the part that's fucking left out is how they do that in the first place. So it's like, oh yeah, well, we're going to do this. And, you know, we're going to do that and we're going to do this. And then like all this shit will just magically fucking fall into place and change. And then, everything will be great. And, before we get to some of the other stuff, I know previously, we didn't go into a lot of detail on it, but, I had talked to Ken about this before, you know, that this whole idea of, okay, well, just campaign or, you know, call your fucking Congress people and all this shit is actually going to change something when, regardless of who you think it is, I think most people would agree the people that are running the country and running the government are not these elected officials. Even if you go to the point where, don't forget about all the government agencies that are just appointed that have this from this rulemaking bill that they had passed. Jesus, it had to be at least, fuck, like 40, 50 years ago, probably even longer. I don't recall the exact year, but the rulemaking bill that basically allows government agencies to make their own fucking laws. So not only do you have that, but then you have whether you want to say it's the multimillionaires, Wall Street, or not millionaires, billionaires, Wall Street, or some secret fucking cabal. I think the majority of people don't really believe that these elected officials are the ones running anything. So how the fuck can you do anything anyway? And this is what I started thinking about. Not like I haven't thought about this before. I try to avoid saying it on the air, but really, a lot of times I come to the point where, what the fuck can you do? So I'd like to, of course, bring Ken on. And again, Ken joins us every month. Check him out at thedailyeconomist.com. So, Ken, before we get into some other stuff, I know we've kind of talked a little about this before in the past, not in a lot of detail, but just the fact that, you know, these people aren't really the people in power or in control of anything.
Oh, true. And like I was mentioning before, okay, this isn't something new. This goes back to ancient Babylon, the Nimrod, you know, that's where our financial system comes from. The Babylonian use of credit and interest and usury. Okay, so this is what we're seeing today is as old as time itself. You create the bureaucracy. You make sure that people do not have a singular point of power to go out with the pitchforks and go out with their complaints. This is why when you go to like the DMV and you talk to the person, the clerk there, they rarely can do more than just the basic things, and when you try to call a manager, they can't make any decisions, and the person who they think can make a decision has gone out to lunch or is not in the office, and 3 months later, you're still not getting anything done. That's the way it's done. It's the bureaucracy is created. Now, what you were saying about agencies and the regulations, that too. You know, the EPA comes out and says carbon dioxide is a pollutant. Well, did Congress vote that in? No. They just arbitrarily said it. And that's what happens when you create these agencies. It creates a bureaucracy, and you have multiple levels creating laws where people do not have redress because they can't just go take their pitchforks and vote out a congressman for it. How are you going to find the head of the EPA or the underlings of the EPA and et cetera, et cetera? So, you know, it's by attrition. The other side of the coin is the elite and the cabal who get power, they get power because the people themselves at a certain point didn't stand up to take charge of whatever the incident is. You know, back in the day, if there was a problem between two different races, two different cultures, two different people, whatever, they'd sit down and they'd deal with the problem themselves. And if they had to get into a fist fight, they got into a fist fight, but eventually got resolved. But when people no longer wanted to take responsibility for things going on in their community, they did the old, well, you know, we need government to do something about it. They abrogated their own responsibility to someone else. And the, you know, when somebody starts tasting power, there's that old axiom, power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. So when you give more power, you know, and you give more responsibility and you give more freedoms to the government, then they're just going to continue to take as far as they can go.
And it's almost like everything's being deflected in a sense that, so the real people that don't really have any power anyway, the elected officials, that's really the only place I guess you can try to take it. Not like that's going to make a fucking difference anyway. And then everybody else, like you said in the example of the DMV, I mean, they can't really do anything anyway. So it's, you're just stuck in this fucking circle, really, of that goes nowhere.
Yeah, do you remember the movie V? V for Vendetta?
Yeah, I actually just watched it again. I think it was either last weekend or the weekend before.
Yeah, for those who have seen it, do you remember the time when he broke into the network station and played his tape? And the one thing he said was this. He goes, you know, I know why you did it. You were afraid. You're fearful. But if there's anybody responsible, all you have to do is look
into
a mirror.
Yeah.
Okay. We complain and we go after and we say all these things about the government. But you know what? In the end, going back to our generations, grandparents, great grandparents, whatever, at a certain point, the government did not have that control. But we, at one point, our ancestors abrogated it to the government. Whether it's the, you know, in the 1907 with the bank panic. That was done to get people to rise up and scream for the government to do something about the banking system. So you create the crisis, and if people are ready to no longer take responsibility for their own actions, then they'll just simply call for the government to do it, and that's how the Fed got in there. Sure, it was put on Jekyll Island, and the whole plan was whatever. But if the people had stood up at that time and said no, which they had done for 100 and some odd years, I mean, so much so that Andrew Jackson has on his epitaph on his tombstone, I killed the bank, they knew exactly what it was. But it was perfect timing because at that time, 1907, 1900, 1910, we had a huge influx of immigrants coming from Europe who were used to being under a central bank. So a lot of the people who voted in, the legislators and the congressmen, whatever, they were immigrants who didn't understand freedom yet. They hadn't lived there long enough. They hadn't been long enough. They could hardly speak the language. And their patrons, who were part of the political machine, like Tammany Hall and Conklin and all that in New York City, they told their immigrants how to vote and what to vote. So...
yeah, and obviously, and I mean, I know we kind of differ a little on this, where I think basically that's just the main intention of government anyway. But to your point about people being able to stop things, you know, obviously there are, you know, I don't know what the ratio is, but if you look at the elite that are running things compared to everybody else, I mean, there's no comparison. You know, if even a small percentage of those people tried to stand up, they'd be able to stop them. But when you're at where we're at now, you know, it's like sometimes thinking about it, like, what can you even do at this point? Because we know that it's not going to work. You know, you can campaign and all that bullshit, maybe you can get some small things done, but in the big scheme of things, it really doesn't make a fucking difference. So I mean, what is really left to do at this point?
Oh, what's left is to come to the realization that what is coming is inevitable. When you accept that fact, when you accept that realization, that what is coming is inevitable. It cannot be changed. The only thing left to do is how are you going to protect yourself in the coming change? That, from day one, going back to 2008, is what a lot of the economists, Peter Schiff, Gerald Celente, talking about getting to know your neighbors, getting to know your community, get out of the system, get out of the banks, get into a hard asset, get out of the stock markets, all of these things. It's been hard for at least the last 7 years, if not a little bit more. Okay. So if you're entering this time right now saying, you know, I've got time, or maybe I shouldn't, or, you know, nothing's going to change. Well, you know what? There's no help. Can't help. You know, you've made up your mind, and to tell the truth, I respect your decision. But when the inevitable takes place, then you're going to have to, people will have to answer for the choice, individual choices and decisions they make. And one of the big ones that's coming up, and people may have heard it, is being bantered about all around, but it's the war on cash. And this is the biggest warning signal that we're about to have another collapse.
And what, I guess, for just the layman, how would you define the war on cash?
The war on cash is where governments, banks, institutions are trying to throw out the idea that it is our ownership of the bills in our wallet, of holding money, us controlling money that's not fully electronic, that is the problem behind all of our financial issues. See, they tried to say back in the 1960s and leading up to 1971, it's gold and silver that's the problem, that we're having economic problems. And you know what? They got that removed from our monetary system. Now they're saying cash. They've been talking to years, whether it's from a religious aspect of a singular financial system or if it's the cabal and the people have read up on it. They want a fully electronic system, because a fully electronic system means they can have absolute control. The reason that holding money and holding cash is important is because it's freedom. If you hold it in your hands, you have the choice of what to spend, when not to spend, to invest, to save, to do anything else. If it's fully electronic, that means you have nothing but a debit card or a credit card. They can shut that off, depending on they consider you somebody who isn't, who's bucking the system. Here's the thing. Because they have dropped interest rates to zero and to negative interest rates in a lot of countries in Europe, that means that they no longer want money in deposit. It's worthless to them, because they have to pay interest on it, or they have to supply, spend manpower and resources dealing with the transactions that occur with cash. Plus the fact that in a cash-based economy or financial system, banks have to have a certain amount of physical cash on deposit at all times. They can't lend it out. They can't leverage it. They can't do that. You get rid of cash and everything's electronic, they'll take that current 30 to 80 times leverage that they have, and they'll do it to infinity.
So basically talking about the fractional reserve banking system, where now, they need whatever, like 10% or something, that you're saying without that cash aspect, that totally goes away and they can just create anything and go and take it as far as they want.
Exactly. See, there's another thing, the freedom of cash. You know what? If you truly want to, you can get out of the system per se, and you can earn a great living by having your money in other assets, in other means. If you don't need a bank, you can pretty much run your entire lifestyle through something like PayPal and a Visa gift card. Because you can use the Visa gift card as any credit card or debit card and pay all your bills. You can bill pay. You can use that, and you're in control. And the bank, they can't confiscate it. Once it's uploaded to that, it's not considered in a bank account. It's then considered one of their secured credits.
Well, Bitcoin,
that's the problem.
Bitcoin as well. There's you know, similar things you can do with that also.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, Dodd-Frank, starting in 2014, most people don't realize this. Dodd-Frank, your bank accounts, your savings account, your checking account, your money market account, your CDs, they are considered unsecured depositors, unsecured creditors. That means that it is a liability. It's the same thing as if they made a loan to you. They owe you the money as a debt. Well, what happened with General Motors when it got nationalized? They decided which holders, you know, whether it's the shareholders, the bondholders, the pensioners, and the workers, they prioritized which one was going to get paid and which ones weren't. The bondholders were then broken into, these are our first secure bondholders, these are second secure, these are third secure. They got paid, like the first secure got 100 cents on the dollar, the second level got 70 cents on the dollar, and the third level got 40 cents on the dollar. The shareholders all got screwed. Gun. You got nothing for your shares. Okay? The workers, or the pension was taken away. It was moved into the national pension fund that the government does to backstop it. So they lost that. And then they redid the company, reissued stock, and it's a completely different thing.
Well, isn't that like just with any company, because when they declare bankruptcy, they get out of all contracts, and the last people to get any money, which usually they never do, is just the regular common stockholders.
Exactly. And that's just it, is there are priorities to which are secured creditors and which are unsecured creditors.
So I want to talk a little about the ramifications, which you kind of touched on, with moving from a cash-based system to, you know, some kind of whatever credit-based or card-type-based system. So one of the things you had mentioned, obviously, and this has been, and I can't think of any of them off the top of my head, it might have been in Minority Report, but where exactly what you said is, your whole, all your money can just be turned off right there. And you've seen in a lot of movies probably where they cancel all someone's credit cards. So they, you know, they can already do that. So they can't use them or whatever. But obviously if you have cash, then you don't have to worry about that part of it. But with a, cashless system, then there's no way to purchase anything in those scenarios. I guess, you know, there could be a more of an underground bartering system, and I'm sure things like that would develop. But in general, it gives total control, I think, not only to things like that, where if you're a quote-unquote enemy of the state, you know, for something stupid, where they can turn that off, but at the same time, it will be hard to for anybody to stand up to anything, for anybody to try to stand up to the state in any way, because they know that everything is controlled there. And not only that, and this they're kind of doing anyway, if you're using credit cards, but everything you buy, they know anyway, unless right now you're buying it with cash. But obviously, again, if cash goes away, then they have a specific, you know, every transaction you make, which again, pretty much they know that now because of debit cards and credit cards, but you still have that option to use cash. But it, you know, that goes away, they have even more information on every single thing you buy, where you buy it at, and all of this stuff as well.
Well, not only that, but here's the thing. If you get rid of cash and force it out of the system, that means every single person will no longer be able to be without a bank account. If you choose not to keep your money in a bank, it's gone. You can't. An electronic system, it has to be stored somewhere, and the banks will get immensely more powerful, because every single individual, like an EBT card, you know, it used to be food stamps. You used to get physical coupon food stamps. Now it's an EBT card. Well, I don't know if people remember about two and a half years ago, but J.P. Morgan had a shutdown or a cyber hack, and the EBT cards were down for 48 hours. And people went nuts. We're talking 50 million people on these things that rely on them for food. So the other thing is and let me go ahead and give a quick list, because some people think, oh, you know, this is just pie in the sky. They'd never do this.
Just briefly, but before you get into that, I saw, and it might have been actually John Stossel who did a special on it. There was something, and it was related to Goldman Sachs and the amount of money that they were making. I believe it was off EBT cards or
J.P. Morgan.
But there was something with Goldman Sachs was involved too. But maybe I'm mistaken. It was just J.P. Morgan. But yeah, but they were actively going out and trying to promote them, that they wanted more people on that form of welfare, essentially, so they could make all this money, and they were making millions off of these cards.
Well, that's just it. Like I said, food stamps used to be controlled by the Department of Agriculture, and you'd get these coupons that said food stamps.
Right.
Then they went electronic.
Stamps.
They
were like stamps.
And then they went electronic, and they gave the contract to J.P. Morgan. So every EBT card is run through J.P. Morgan, and J.P. Morgan gets a cut from doing all the processing for all these EBT cards. So, yeah, I mean, the government has tons of different programs that they dole out benefits, and I'm sure Goldman Sachs is tied to a number. But I want to give a list here, because people want to ask, this will never happen in America, or that only happens in Zimbabwe when they go, complete hyperinflation. This is enacted. These are enacted right now. Italy has made cash transactions over 1,000 euros illegal. Switzerland has proposed banning cash payments in excess of 100,000 francs. Russia has banned cash transactions over 10,000 rubles.
So what does that exactly mean, that if there is a transaction that costs that much money, that it cannot be made in cash?
Correct. I'll give an example. If you go to if you want to buy a car from your neighbor and you want to pay cash, and it's more than 1,000 euros in Italy, you're busted. You're going to jail, and this is not a misdemeanor. These are all felonies. And, you can mess with anything with the government, but when you start messing with money, that's when they get the highest felonies.
Well, that's why robbing banks, is so much more serious than robbing, like, a gas station, because
exactly.
Then you're dealing with the federal government. But there was –
There's a couple other ones I want to –
Oh, go ahead.
Important ones I want to do here. France has made cash transactions of 1,000 euros illegal, down from a previous limit of 3,000. Now, here's the two big ones. J.P. Morgan Chase issued a letter in late March. They are banning customers from paying for mortgages, student loans, and their credit card payments with cash.
So
a bank will not allow you to pay off your debts with cash,
which is insane, of course. So what are you supposed to do with are you supposed to deposit your money into a bank and then pay with a check?
Yeah, they do not want to give you the potential, when the collapse comes, to do a bank run.
That's what they're doing,
trying to eliminate the possibility of a bank run. Now, here's the last big one. The state of Louisiana, the entire state, this is not a bank, this is the entire state of Louisiana, they have passed a law banning cash for purchases of used or secondhand goods. That means that if you go to a garage sale, if you use cash, you just committed a felony. If you buy a car from your neighbor, secondhand car, you just committed a felony. Think about this. Who has secondhand goods for sale? Goodwill, Salvation Army, all of these places that sell secondhand goods, you cannot no longer use cash to buy them.
And that, of course, is insane. I mean, because
the entire state of Louisiana passed this.
When it comes down to it, and I know, obviously, one of the things, too, is what I would think is about, you know, being able to track everything. Because if you think about it with debit cards now, what the fuck is a debit card? A debit card is just a card backed by your cash in the bank. So yeah. What is the fucking difference?
And it's convenience that you don't see the convenience with electronic banking. And I'm not saying there's no pros with electronic banking. It's much more convenient. If somebody steals your debit card, if they go to an ATM, they're only going to be able to take out about $300 a day. By then, you can call and get it canceled and such. Credit cards
are
backed by
they'd have to have your password too. I mean, they might.
Well, yeah,
not
but
even
you
be
can
able
always
do that.
You can always change that in 24 hours. But banks, credit cards, most credit card companies will back you for any illegal charges on that. So there are pros on it. But here's the thing. Okay, here's where we get to the big part. If you've got an economic collapse in the world and the dollar, which we have talked about, you know, over several times over the past months, the dollar is going away. Period. It's going to come back in some other type of form, but the dollar, the petrodollar, the reserve currency as we know it, is going away. It should have gone away in April or January of 2014. When about 120 nations signed an agreement to do a global currency reset where they were going to get rid of the dollar as the reserve currency, and instead of all currencies being tied to the dollar, they were going to go back to a gold standard where all currencies were valued in gold. But one country decided that they didn't want to give up that power, and of course we know who that is, the United States. So instead of following through with this treaty that they had signed at one of the G20 meetings or such, they decided that they would start a war, and that's why the Ukraine war went into thing. Because as long as there's a war going on, then the world cannot get together and have another quote-unquote Bretton Woods, cannot do this agreement.
And
so this is why you see the U.S. in perpetual war. It's because they know that the dollar, the world is rejecting the dollar. It's about, you know, it's going to lose its reserve currency status, but as long as they can keep tearing down countries that are standing up against the dollar. You know why Libya was attacked? Why Gaddafi was killed? Because he had gotten with a number of different African nations, and they were going to create their own global currency backed by gold. An African, it wasn't a dinar. There is talk right now the Middle East is going to create their own dinar currency backed by gold. There's a Nordic euro that's going to be backed by gold. That's why they don't mind if Greece exits, because they want to do that. The world is coming to a gold-backed system, everybody but the United States, because the United States, the instant the dollar, we have so much debt, and we have offshored our manufacturing so much that if we lose reserve currency status, we are instantly a third world nation.
And that's something that, you know, because people say, ah, oh, there's just people, conspiracy theories and stuff like that. But the governor of, somebody running for the governor of Texas or running for senator in Texas actually had brought that up as well, that talked about, hey, if the U.S. dollar at some point is no longer the reserve currency, that we're going to be in a lot of trouble. So, I think it was actually on Glenn Beck, but it was still someone who, again, they were either running for senator or governor, and they were leading the race, meaning that it seems like a lot of these things are even getting into the mainstream to a certain extent.
Oh, yeah. Well, see, like I said, in January of 2014, there was an attempt by 120 nations that came to an agreement in the treaty that just wasn't put out in the news very much to see what they could do to stave off the next collapse by going back to a gold standard, go back thing. Now, China, Russia, and the BRICS nations were all for this, doing it as a group. But when the United States decided to, you know, give them the middle finger and instead try to go after Russia through Ukraine, that's when China and Russia and the BRICS really went full bore and said, you know what, the United States is a rogue nation. They're not going to, you know, that's a great question. When has the United States ever kept their treaties? They didn't with the Native Americans.
Never.
Exactly.
What about with, and I don't know if you'd call these treaties, but what about agreements quote-unquote agreements with the American people and the things that are supposed to be, you know, if you want to the Constitution or the Bill of Rights. When are those been kept? Because they're definitely not now.
That's what happens when you had the banking cabal take over. They started in Europe in the 1650s to 1700, and then it migrated over. As a matter of fact, the War of 1812, most people don't know the War of 1812 was about the bank. The War of 1812 was for two reasons. It's because Britain could have easily sent over so many ships that we would have broken up as a nation in within two decades of getting, you know, the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. But they came over, and see, there was a nice little thing most people don't realize unless you really search it, the 13th Amendment. The 13th Amendment, most people think, is a Civil Rights Act passed after the removal of slavery. No. The 13th Amendment was a law banning Americans from taking titles. Okay, you're not allowed to have a title, because that's what before this constitutional amendment came through, the British were buying off American politicians by giving them titles and promises of land in the old colonies if they would do their bidding. Well, that's when the amendment came through, so you couldn't have a title, and so the British came over and did the War of 1812, and the first thing they did is they went to every single federal courthouse and they took and burned the wet ink documents of the 13th Amendment. As a matter of fact, they took one was found in like a little tiny courthouse in Maine 50 years after the fact. They had been so eradicated. Well, why is this important? This is important because the British decided to leave and end the War of 1812 when they got two things. They got the first charter for the bank. Okay, this wasn't the central bank, but it was the first charter of a national bank. And they got the legal system. The British control our legal system. You know what the term bar means? Bar is British Accreditation Registry. And every single this is why when you see lawyers, you see their names at the end. It says Esquire. Esquire is a title. Right. It's a title of nobility. We're not supposed to have that according to the original 13th Amendment, but since that was eradicated and pretty much forgotten by the country, now lawyers are, when you pass the bar, you are signed under the British Accreditation Registry. The Britain and the Queen own our entire legal system. Does that sort of now open up your eyes to, like, now I know why so many of these laws and the rulings of the judges and this is what's happened?
Yeah, and I've heard a lot about, you know, how bad the American Bar Association is as well and all the shit that they do. But it seems like if you look through history – And obviously, you know a hell of a lot more than me with your background, but that at least maybe in the past 400 or 500 years that England is kind of like the root of all evil there, that all of these, you know, a lot of these things you can trace back to them.
Yes. Yes. And no, you know, Queen Elizabeth and her family, they're not even quote unquote British. They're German. Back in the day, you know, during World War One, Kaiser Wilhelm, who was the king over Germany,
right,
was related to Tsar Nicholas in Russia and related to the prince who was in charge of Britain at the time. They were all interrelated. As a matter of fact, Queen Victoria didn't even speak English. She spoke German. And what they did was they actually created a formalized language of English that is much different than what the islanders had before then. Because most of Britain, up until you got the time of the aristocracy all mixing in, and like I said, Queen Elizabeth and her ancestry is German. Before you had that, a great deal of the rise of the British Isles were the Vikings. When the Vikings raided, after they were finally stopped, those that were still on the land just melted into the British Isles and took over the land, and there was huge parts. That's why there's so much Viking history in Britain, is because a lot of their ancestral stock is Viking.
The other thing, and I think I brought this up to you before on the air, that doesn't the Queen of England, and I think it's not even limited to one country, but even with Canada, have some kind of power or control over, I know Canada for one, but some other countries also.
16 Commonwealths.
Okay, there you go, yeah.
There are 16 Commonwealths, and that includes Australia, New Zealand. They had Hong Kong for a while, up until the 1999 end of the 100-year lease. But, yeah, there's like 16 Commonwealths that they control the land. Now, they allow the countries to have their own individual government, but that's sophistry. The important rulings are always done from the crown, and the people just don't realize it. It's like in Canada. You can buy land, but it is not what is called fee simple. Fee simple means that you own the land and you loan everything under the land. Like you would own the water rights and the mining rights and whatever. In Canada, you don't. If you buy land, you only own the surface. That means that somebody can go to the crown and get pay for mining rights to your land. They can tear up your land, mine the heck out of it, as long as they put it back on the surface as what it was, and you don't get a red cent. The crown owns the land.
Yeah,
except for what you buy on the surface. So here in the States, at least, it's fee simple. You know, that's how you get so many North Dakotans all of a sudden, old farmers of tons of millionaires. Because when the oil companies did all this fracking in the Bakken region, they had to pay a percentage to mine, you know, get the oil from the land underneath. So all these old farmers suddenly became millionaires.
Well, yeah, but unfortunately, the government still owns your land anyway because you pay your rental fees to them based on, you know, whatever fucking equation they come up with on what you're going to pay for your property taxes. But even with, you know, I don't think I even knew about that with Canada until recently. And then I think I brought it up to you on the air. And I think the way I found out about it is because I was buying some Canadian coins, you know, gold and silver.
The queen,
and yeah, there's the queen on it. And I'm like, what the fuck is the queen doing on a Canadian coin? And then I looked into it further and saw, you know, the connection there. And then that it wasn't just Canada. It's all these other countries as well. It's insane. That's why when you think about and people talk about conspiracy theories and, oh, well, there's no way that could happen and people not know about it. But you can just look at basic shit that people don't know about. So obviously, if there's all these things that are not, you know, necessarily detrimental to a lot of things and people don't know about them, then obviously it's very plausible that there's all this other shit that you don't know about neither.
Yeah. Well, what they do is they hide reality behind symbols. Okay. That, I mean, if you want to think about one of the biggest symbols in the world is why is the man who on his, like I said, on his tombstone said, I killed the bank. Why is that man's picture on a Federal Reserve note, on the $20 bill? Andrew Jackson would come back from the grave and burn the Fed to the ground if he knew that. But this is the way the cabal. It's like taking a shot at Jackson, the one man who despised the bank. And he, as a matter of fact, he was the last president to have a balanced budget and have us a surplus. So, you know, it's symbolism. It's like saying, the Fed is saying, you know what, Andrew Jackson, you may have stopped us in the short run, but you're dead, and we're going to put your picture on here so you can be here forever.
Yeah, and that's where, you know, I don't know how much I buy into all of the, you know, quote-unquote Illuminati symbols and whatever, because I think with some things, I think it's, you know, it's borderline ridiculous. But with some of them, I think, you know, that there is, I think, some validity to that there's some stuff that's out there.
You know why it's important? It doesn't matter if you believe it or I believe it. They believe it.
Right, right.
So you have to act as if they believe it's true. And so when numerology, why is 9/11 important? Why was, you know, we had the attack on the Twin Towers 9/11, then we had another terror attack on 9/11. They do these things. It's like, it goes back, like I said, it goes back in ancient history. The if you take a look at Jewish history, okay, the one thing, there are certain feasts and festivals that bring blessings and promises to them, okay, whether it's Shavuot, whether it's Pentecost, Passover, etc. But there are also, in the middle of summer, there is what is known as the ninth of Tammuz. I forget the number, the date, but Tammuz. On that day, the first Jewish temple was razed to the ground. On that day, centuries later, the second temple was razed to the ground on that exact same day. Anything that has been of detriment and disaster to the Jewish people, so much of it has happened on the on that day. I think it's on that day. So how can you plan these things over hundreds or thousands of years to be on the exact same day? There's importance in this. Is why astrology, you know, if it was a fraud and a fake, people wouldn't study it. The Russians have a book out there where they do their stock markets based on astrology. You have the Martin Armstrong, who talks about cycles. Everything's in cycles. 1914 was World War One. It was a war cycle. You know what? The world is heading to war right now. It's exactly 100 years later. There are cycles out there. There are symbols out there. That numerology is functional. It doesn't mean you have to believe it or follow it, but you have to realize that those in power who have based their power on ancient civilizations and what they followed, just like, you've got the Mayans, the Mayan calendar. You have all these in every civilization throughout the earth, the Egyptians, it doesn't matter. They believed it not because they were kooks or they thought that, you know, they were just idiots. It's because they actually meant something and it actually came true based on their calculations. So there is significance and importance. And think about this. I don't know if I mentioned this on your show or if you had talked about it, but earlier this year, Christine Lagarde of the IMF did a speech where she said to this group of people at the Council on Foreign Relations, let's talk about the significance of the number 7 and the numerology of 7. And she went on the entire speech about 7 and its significance.
I did hear that. I don't know if it was from you or I heard it on something else, but yeah, I did hear that.
They believe these things and they do their actions based on astrology, right. Well, on numerology, and on significance of symbols.
That's where, and take a quick break in a minute. But I mean, some of the things I honestly do think that when you're looking to relate something to something else, it's a lot easier to do it. But I don't know if you've ever seen there's two movies that always come to mind when I think of some of this stuff. And one was The Believers with Martin Sheen, and one was Angel Heart with they're both 80s movies. I don't know if you've seen them, with Mickey Rourke. And basically, it was about the especially with Angel Heart, was about kind of the rich elite and all of these things that they did because they believed. By, of course, in the movie it was real, you know, they believed that by doing these rituals and selling themselves to the devil and all of this stuff, that they would get all of these riches and all of these things, and things like that. And I think that with some of these things, you know, again, the conspiracy theories, but I know, you know, Alex Jones did that whole, was a Bohemian Grove and some of that stuff. And I think some of these people, they really, now I don't think it's real, but I think as you're, like you're saying, that they think it's real, with some of the stuff like that, some of the occult. And, in the movie The Believers with Martin Sheen, it was like a cult where they killed like the firstborn sons for the same reason, to get, you know, riches and success in life and all of these things. And again, I mean, there is some information out there that, you know, whether it's true or not, that they're doing these things. And I don't know if they're going to the point where they're literally killing people, but with some of these rituals that they actually believe that, hey, if we do this, this is going to give us what we want and our money and our success and all of this shit. I don't know what your thoughts are on that, but
well, you got to remember, it's not just the fact that they're doing it here in the 20th and 21st century. They're doing it because the ancient Babylonians did it, the Sumerians did the Jews did it, the Persians did it, the Egyptians did it, the Mayans did it. They did it, okay? Do you think the intelligentsia of today, living in an era of science and reason and logic, would succumb themselves to supernatural rituals if it didn't actually come to fruition? We're not talking that they just believe this. It has to have evidence that it works. Now,
yeah, but
I don't want to delve into that dark, you know,
yeah.
That dark thing that they do. But you know what? L. Ron Hubbard in his writings, when he, you know, before he created Scientology, he worked with Aleister Crowley, and they did a ritual where they tried to, I think they got two victims to have sexual intercourse, and right when they were coming to orgasm, they slaughtered a child so that somehow the blood sacrifice would cause a demon to enter the woman and the child would be born as a, they believe this stuff and they fulfill it. And what is L. Ron Hubbard's Scientology? Scientology may not be big in some circles, but it's big enough. Okay. They believe it. They fulfill it. They do it. If it didn't work in some aspects, in some regards, whether it's karma that you come from India or, you know, whatever, something happens, whether there's a frequency in the earth, and if it isn't from a supernatural entity or an evil supernatural entity, there's something in the earth that causes these things. There's something in astrology that causes these things, et cetera, you know. So,
yeah, but I mean, I think it's more, and to, without getting into too much detail, I mean, again, like if you want to try to relate something to something else, there's a way of looking at it, and people will look at things with blinders on and try to, you know, associate this to this and whatever. But I don't doubt that they believe it. I think obviously a lot of these people that are doing these things, whoever they are, that they do believe what they're doing is helping them to achieve whatever they're trying to achieve. Now,
and they're the ones in power, and they have all the money, and they are doing a very good job of getting total control. So something they are doing must be working.
Yeah, but they could have got to that point, you know, before, you know, like people that get brought in where they already get to a certain level of success. I mean, I don't know. It's definitely an interesting thing to, you know, talk about. And that movie Angel Heart, and I don't know, again, if you have seen it with Mickey Rourke, it was actually one of my favorite movies.
I was too young back when I came in the 80s, but I will say this. Hollywood puts out,
well, you're older than me.
But I was in high school then, so I wasn't seeing our movies. But no, just remember this, and this is why I'm in agreement with you on this. Hollywood puts out in movies what they want to desensitize people to eventually come. Okay,
right.
You know, we had how many alien movies, and superhero movies and all these things, when they start coming in proliferation, that means that the powers that be have something up their sleeve that they're going to bring upon the masses, and they don't want to do panic, so they desensitize you into believing, you know what, there can be superheroes. There can be aliens. So when then they come, you're like, oh, yeah, we knew about that. I've already programmed to accept it.
Yeah, there was a post on Facebook that somebody posted there where it literally had every superhero movie from about 2015 now, you know, in a couple months, all the way to like 2020. And there's like 100 of them. There's so many, you know, superhero movies coming out. And, you know, to your point, you know, obviously for a reason. But I want to take a break. I don't want to say quick break because I want to play, since we're going to get in a little into Jade Helm, I do have a clip from a city council meeting in Texas that I had played before where somebody from the military is going through and explaining their quote unquote version of what's going on with Jade Helm. And there's, I think in this one, there may be some questions as well. So I'm going to play that. And when we come back, we'll talk a little about that and other things. And we're here with Ken Schortgen of The Daily Economist. Check him out at thedailyeconomist.com. And check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. And we'll be right back after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
I bring you greetings from Fort Bragg, North Carolina, United States Army Special Operations Command. I just want to be able to thank you all for allowing me to speak tonight to the City Council of Big Spring. This is an honor for us to be here to address you and give you some information on the exercise that we'll be conducting this summer in Howard County. My name's Tom Mead. I'm a retired Special Forces Senior Noncommissioned Officer. I spent 20 years in the Army and spent 13 with Special Operations. I'm currently a contractor working for United States Army Special Operations Command as an operations planner and an exercise designer for the Jade Helm project. With me this evening, I have Master Sergeant Tim Robinson. He's an active duty Green Beret with 3rd Special Forces Group out of Fort Bragg. Tim's helping us design this exercise to get it going, make sure it goes in the right direction. So my purpose here this evening is we are seeking written invitation and approval from local officials to conduct the realistic military training exercise within the jurisdiction of the city of Big Spring. Through the process, we're required, as I'm here tonight, is to receive to ask for a letter of invitation from local officials inviting us into your community to allow us to train our soldiers for the next fight that we could that they could encounter. We're not training for Afghanistan and Iraq, the things that we've done in the last 15 years. We're looking forward, and we want to make sure that these guys are trained properly. This is where we need the help of the local communities. We coordinate with all the local, state, and federal law enforcement. We've already been and we've coordinated with the police chief here in Big Spring. We've coordinated with Sheriff Parker already. We have coordinated up at DPS at the state level already. So everybody from a law enforcement aspect understands what the exercise is, and we want to make sure that we are completely plugged in with them to make sure they understand what's going on. The land use agreements that we do with the local public, we don't just come in to somebody's property and we won't trespass on somebody's property without the agreement of that landowner. The licensing agreement truly allows us, or it releases liability from the landowner. And we do a full risk assessment and medical plan. We've already linked in with the hospital. We understand how they get the life flight. We also have medical personnel that will be on site to assist should anything happen. What is Jade Helm? Jade Helm is a challenging 8-week exercise. truly in this area, in the Martin and Howard County area, we're only going to be here for about 5 to 5.5 weeks. The 8 weeks comes in where it's the preparation and the planning that happens back in Florida and in the Mississippi area. The exercise is a joint military and interagency activity. What this means is we have units from every military service participating in the exercise with us. And we also have some of our interagency partners, such as the FBI, the DEA, and some of the other agencies assisting us and working with us in the exercise. The exercise is going to be throughout 7 states. Texas is the main bulk of the activity, I would tell you. And we are spread from east to west, north to south, throughout the state of Texas. It is a Special Operations Command General Votel sponsored exercise to improve Special Operations Forces' ability to conduct unconventional warfare as part of the national security. The exercise will occur from July to September. What we see here in Martin and Howard County is the guys will come in about August 7th or so, and they'll depart somewhere about September 10th or so. Who's participating? As you can see, it's all of our special operators. United States Army Special Forces Command, the Green Berets, Navy SEALs will be conducting operations over in Mississippi and Louisiana. The Air Force Special Operations Command will be flying specialty aircraft for us for infiltration and resupply of the operators on the ground. The Marine Special Operators will be working down in the San Antonio area. And the 82nd Airborne Division will jump an entire battalion into Camp Bullis and take down targets inside Camp Bullis on a federal installation. The exercise locations in this area, we're working throughout Martin and Howard County. As some of you know, we briefed the Howard County Commissioner's Court yesterday morning. We received approval to operate within Howard County. Why did we choose Texas? Number one, United States Special Operations Command has been conducting exercises in Texas for a few years. We've done numerous exercises here. A lot of times you don't hear a lot about it unless someone like me comes to brief you about those exercises. And we know that Texans are historically supportive of our efforts to make sure that our soldiers, sailors, and airmen and Marines are ready to fight that next fight and train them for that next fight. What some of the things that we require is areas of undeveloped land with low population densities. United States Army Special Operations Command, being the director of the exercise, desires to have a very rural area for us to be able to operate in. Because the last few years, these guys have, in Afghanistan and Iraq, they receive aerial resupply by helicopter about once a week. They live in buildings. They have connectivity to the internet to be able to talk to their command, but also be able to talk to home. When they come out here to Martin and Howard County, they're not going to have those luxuries. In the scenario that we've built, they're going to have to operate outside of those normal support mechanisms and rely on the folks, the civilians that are in the area to be able to support them. We have a backside support element that actually will replicate that, but we also we can't do the exercise without the public's help. Things that we look for from that perspective is we look for people that are willing to be a role player, to just be someone who goes and gives a little nugget of information for them to build an intelligence picture to understand the scenario better and be able to operate better. We look for people that are willing to transport our guys because they have to move around in a clandestine manner. For example, in the back of a horse trailer in the middle of the night so nobody can see them. These are ways that they have to operate in foreign countries and when they're not supposed to be in those countries. We also look for landowners and business owners who would be willing to allow us to, on a landowner perspective, to be able to use their land, maybe live on their land, or to use a barn or an old barn to be able to conduct a meeting in the middle of the night for them to do planning with a higher command element. Shop owners to be able to use a back storeroom or a warehouse to do these types of meetings as well. They have to be, they operate in and around communities because that's the way we operate throughout the globe. Ordinary citizens are the first ones to notice something that's different. And that, you know, it causes them to have to be that much more careful. What can you expect? Now, understand that this this slideshow is our standard slideshow that we use to brief the counties and the cities. Within the cities, you won't see most of this, I would tell you. For example, increased aircraft in the area at night. You'll see that out in the rural area. We have a resupply, an aerial drop that will occur, and then some paratroopers as well will jump into Martin County in early August. It won't happen within the city limits. But one of the most important things, and I know I've said it previously, is we link in with the law enforcement officers. They know when and where we're conducting activity. That way, we actually invite the police department to be near the activity. That way, they're able to answer constituent calls on that. The other thing that we do is we brief that prior to the activity going on. That way, the police chief can let the dispatch know that this is occurring, so that when they field phone calls from concerned citizens, they're able to meet that off at, or cut that off at the pass. But that's not normally anything that's out of the ordinary in West Texas from what I've seen, especially during hunting season. And they may be driving civilian vehicles throughout the area. So really, within the city limits, if you notice my guys, they're probably really doing something wrong. Clear marking of the participants. That for us, that's one of the big things. We make sure that all of our guys have some type of marking that they'll all be wearing an armband with a marking that identifies them as part of the exercise. So if I and what I mean by that is just as we do with the law enforcement, if there's activity occurring around an area, we will actually go out to doors and knock on doors, introduce ourselves, and let them know that there'll be activity happening between this time and this time.
Mr. Mead, how often do you do an operation like this? Is this done annually or?
Yes, sir. So the Jade Helm project is a new project that has come along from General Cleveland, from his staff at United States Army Special Operations Command. This exercise is planned to be conducted yearly. We conduct an exercise that's similar to this, and I say similar because the scope and the breadth of the exercise is nowhere comparable to what we do here. But they conduct that exercise six times a year in North Carolina. So, did I answer your question, sir?
Sure.
Thank you, sir.
I was just had a couple of questions, and you've already started talking to the landowners and
yes, sir.
Setting things up. I just have to ask, how does FBI and DEA work with the military on the operation like this?
Well, generally speaking, sir, the FBI and DEA provide us liaison officers up at our command level, depending on how the scenario is written. One of the ways the FBI and DEA are working with us here is in Arizona, they will actually do some questioning for us at one of the airports in Arizona. In Arizona, they will actually do some questioning for us at one of the airports in Arizona.
Do y'all use any personnel from NATO, UN, or or
no, sir,
DHS?
Not,
or?
Currently for Jade Helm, it is U.S. only. That has been one of the discussions that I'm not sure if it has occurred yet, but that has been one of the discussions that I'm not sure if it has occurred yet, but not sure if it has occurred yet, but that I'm not sure if it has occurred yet, but
name, please. About 3 minutes. We got a lot of speakers.
My name's Kimberly York, and I actually am one of the county residents. And I'm a little distressed with the fact, A, the county issued an invitation without letting the citizens know that it's going on in the county. I think that we should have been informed. I feel like it's being hidden from us about, you know, and then all of a sudden an invitation's issued and it's on us. And I'm a little bit concerned about that. I think as citizens we have the right. I also am a hospice nurse. I have a lot of concerns about our elderly population in this county and in this city by things that are going on and being distressed. It may double our phone calls for home health and hospices, because we will be the first persons you call, they call, and get distressed. You know, I mean, what the press is putting out is really different than what we're seeing here today. You know, the press is telling us, oh, you're not going to hear about it, you're not going to see it, you know, it's just not going to affect your lives. Well, what we're reading here is that it might affect our lives. And I think as citizens of this county, we should have a voice in whether that invitation is issued. I've got some, like I said, some real concerns. There's safeties for civilians. Why are we looking at safety issues if there's nothing to see here right now? By the way, I am a military brat. I do support the military. I feel that there's other ways of training than inflicting it on the citizens of this county. Thank you.
Thank you.
Promoting the ideas of true freedom and liberty, Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with Dave Bourne.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. We are here with the Daily Economist, Ken Schortgen. That was a clip I played. We did do a show a couple weeks back where we talked a lot about Jade Helm, but I want to get Ken's input there and how that kind of also links to the economy as well. But Ken, have you heard in that or any other speeches related to the military going out and I guess doing their public relations with, you know, city councils and things like that?
Oh, I haven't heard any anything that, but I'll tell you what, I'm surprised, and this tells you right here, people are upset because after the Civil War, Congress passed a law called posse comitatus.
Right.
It means that the United States military would never again be sent in to do policing duties. Now, they're using this, guys, as an exercise. But here's the thing. There are hundreds of military bases, Navy, Army, Air Force, on the United States CONUS. There is also hundreds of thousands of square miles of federal land. You should know. You live in Nevada.
Right. Wasn't it you too that
they can do their, yeah, but they can do their exercises there.
Right, right. But wasn't it also you who had told me as well, there's like a Navy base in the middle of the desert or something too.
Yeah, well, there's a Navy base in the middle of Idaho.
Yeah, that's you had told me that. But yeah, that was my. I mean, first of all, even if you assume for a second that everything they said is true, which I don't, but let's just say we do. I mean, most of the shit doesn't make sense. And the first point being, like what you're saying. They have all of this other land, and you know this is unprecedented. They've never done anything like this before. They're talking about just blending in with the public, using people's land. They even mentioned, I don't know if you caught the what they mentioned the DEA and that the DEA is going to work with them in questioning people at the airport in Arizona.
Yeah, the FBI. There were three things that stuck out in that, and this is what people have to catch: is one, the speaker paused in a number of different places. Most importantly, he finally came out and said, "Oh, this is the first time we're doing this exercise." That should be a red flag. Why are you doing this exercise? Don't give me this, you need training for Afghanistan or whatever. By the way, did you hear what he said? He said, for the future, for the next conflict, not Afghanistan, not Iraq, but the future. You know what that really means? That is subtitled saying, we see our next enemy is domestic. Because they have far enough training, they have bases all around the world.
Right.
That they could do these training for urban contact.
Yeah,
or whatever.
It's hundreds. I mean, that's just what we know about, you know. And I'm sure there's bases that we don't even know about. And the other thing that they had talked about as well is just the. It seems like that whole and to your point, that integration into just. American society and how they're, you know, like they're trying to infiltrate stuff, or it's just none of it makes any fucking sense to me whatsoever. And again,
I want to bring up an important point. What is significant about both 9/11 and the Boston Marathon massacre? On both those days, the government was doing an exercise in both those locations. The FBI had 200 agents there at the Boston Marathon, and nobody saw a thing. The Pentagon was doing war games in over New York City. They had aircraft in the air, and nobody did a thing.
Well, yeah, okay. It's the deniability when they have the drills or whatever.
What it also does, you know, is it leaves two questions. One, are they really that bad? Is our military that bad and ignorant that they're not paying attention to what's pinpoint going on and these things are allowed to happen? Or two, the military and or the federal agencies are there to ensure that whatever's going to happen happens. Now, think about this. Haven't we known for at least a month that ISIS is within 8 miles of the Texas border? So why would there be no federal agencies protecting Pamela Geller when she's having this, cartoon day for Muhammad? Why is it when right across the border, a few miles away, is quote-unquote ISIS, and you're going to be doing an event that's going to defame Muhammad? And sure enough, two ISIS people from Arizona who the FBI had been tracking for 20 years go and do this. What does that tell you? See, here's the thing. Here's the thing about Jade Helm. Jade Helm may start out innocuous. It may go through its full culmination as innocuous, but it's going to accomplish several things. One, it's going to desensitize people for the military being involved in law enforcement, being on your streets, interacting with people, and having authority. Okay? People will forget posse comitatus because they're going to be desensitized that military can be around and anywhere. Two, you're going to have the military involved at a time when, quote unquote, they've already dropped in the press that ISIS is on the Texas border. That means that the potential for false flag events could happen at any time, anywhere. All they have to do is have something happen and say, oh, look, that was ISIS. Third, and this is the primary thing we're going to talk about. There's a former commodities broker by the name of Bill Holter who's been going up doing the rounds on talk radio. And he was with a very big gold and silver firm for a number of years, being a writer for them. And now he's actually going to start working with Jim Sinclair. Jim Sinclair was a guy who almost became the Treasury Secretary under Ronald Reagan. This guy is as smart and as connected as they come. Bill Holders was asked about Jade Helm, and he says, a lot of the propaganda and scuttlebutt that's coming out, he says, I really don't believe it. However, the timing of Jade Helm is what is really important, because already we have, I can name off a dozen economists from Catherine Austin Fitz, Martin Armstrong, Gerald Celente, the list goes on, of individuals who believe and have put their reputations on the line that saying by September, October, we are going to have that collapse, okay? And when is Jade Helm going to be there? July 13th through September 13th. What happens if there's an economic collapse and all of a sudden you have the military in a number of states with all of their equipment? They can turn on martial law in an instant. They don't have to deploy. They're already here. They have already probably gone through and made databases of who's got what, where people live, et cetera, et cetera. They have all this information. They just need an event to be able to in place.
Right.
Now, here's the thing that Holter, and I'm in agreement with him on this, is no matter what, in no instance, is it going to be a matter of going door to door. I don't think they have the capacity, the potential. They're not going to go door to door. They're not going to go confiscating guns. They're not going to go after dissidents. There's no FEMA camps but what can they do? They can control the access routes in and out of a city. They can control the transportation routes of food in and out of a city. It's because everybody is so packed like sardines in huge cities these days, and the amount of food that's in grocery stores is only really, it has to be replaced every 3 days. It's good for about 3 or 4 days, and people have already bought it all out. That's how you control a city. You control it with utilities, you control it with the transportation routes, you control it with bringing in food, okay? So if there's an economic collapse, we already know from a U.S. representative who you can check it on YouTube, he's from Oklahoma, who in Congress, when Hank Paulson, on the weekend that they voted on the bailout, Hank Paulson went into most of Congress, had a closed-door meeting, and said that if you do not bail out these banks with taxpayer money, then we will have to call martial law. We almost went into martial law in 2008, and this representative from Oklahoma went on the floor of Congress and said that they were told that martial law would be instilled. Okay, so we already know, and Congress already knows, that the executive branch, who controls the military, isn't playing around. We have an economic collapse. This is going to be far, 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 far worse. And you know what? I'm going to remove the word if. When it occurs, it's going to be far, far, far worse than 2008. There's going to be no taxpayer bailouts. There's going to be bank holidays. This is one of the reasons why now they're starting to talk about the war on cash. And banks like JP Morgan are already saying you can't use cash for transactions. They're trying to cut it off. They're trying to get people to divest themselves and be ready for a cashless society. Because the Fed no longer has any bullets. The next time they do QE, it's going to be hyperinflation. The world is already dumping all of their treasuries back. The Chinese and the BRICS have already built up infrastructures. And the second that China decides that they're going to announce how much gold they really have, you only need to think about it. The United States in its heyday at Fort Knox, when we were on a gold standard, had about 8,700 tons of gold. China, from all estimates from valid sources, has 30,000 tons.
Yeah, and I know
they could back their currency with gold in an instant, and the dollar, the world would just say, we no longer want the dollar. You wouldn't need a Bretton Woods. You wouldn't need a get-together of G20 nations. They would say, screw this. We want something that's valid, that's solid, that's not longer built on debt. Created on debt.
And we've talked about Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt. But yeah, we've talked about kind of how that has progressed, you know, over the past few months as well, as how, you know, China's been buying up more and more gold, and how that could eventually affect the gold price. One of the things, though, I wanted to bring up and get your take on this as well, as again, I'm trying to look at this from, you know, two different perspectives. So I'm looking at it from what they're putting out there. And obviously, you know, anybody at this point that believes what the government says, you know, as opposed to people calling conspiracy theorists crazy, I would call them crazy. And I think there's less and less that actually believe what the government says. But again, even going back to, I think looking at just what they're even saying is scary enough. When you talk go ahead.
First, they kept it hidden. Okay?
Right.
This guy who's speaking, the lady who was asking the questions, nobody knew about anything. All we got was in the press. You're coming down here and talking to our administrators at the last second, just a month and a half before it's going to do, and then you're telling us this has already been in the plans and the works.
Yeah, they had no choice. They were forced into it, I think, because stuff got leaked where they probably felt like they were in a position where they couldn't avoid not saying anything anymore.
Right. And when you do something in secret, I mean, see, this is the thing, is Americans, for the most part, take out the Vietnam War and the protesters and that, which up to a point is understandable because we have been in perpetual war since World War II. Take out that. Americans will back the military to the hilt, minus the few dissidents, you know, whatever.
Well, I'm not one of those people, just for the record. So
okay, that's fine. I don't support the military policies of my government, but being as I was in the Air Force for 8 years, I'm not going to denigrate the individuals unless they actually follow through with something against the people. When that happens, then all bets are off. But up until that point that happens, okay, most Americans, as the lady said, you know what, I was an Air Force brat or a military brat, I support the military, et cetera, et cetera. People, if they're told the truth and they're told what's going on and they're given a chance to digest it, will go ahead and, from more often than not, accept these things. But when something is done in secret, and then when you ask them questions, like a number of people did in that audio we listened to, the speaker had to pause a lot of times, and I know there was some reverberations where he repeated himself.
Yeah, well, I think it was edited on purpose. Like, right. Just to clarify that, because they wanted to show whoever, you know, posted it out there on YouTube, wanted to repeat it to make sure people heard. Okay, like one of the questions was they asked about NATO troops. And then he kind of said, well, not that we know. First, it sounded like no, but then he's like, well, but we haven't discussed it yet. And then he replayed it right again. But so, yeah.
Exactly. And that's what I'm saying, is he didn't give a straight answer. And you know what? There's already been proof that there's NATO troops out there. Whether they're going to function on military bases, well, a lot of military personnel are gone. But it's already been cited in evidence that there are NATO troops already in the United States. Why they'd be involved? One, the U.S. military shouldn't be doing this because of the law, posse comitatus. Two, you start bringing in NATO troops, that's going to, you know, it's people, the people who are awake are questioning and wondering, but a lot of the people who are awake are, like I said, they realize the inevitable. They see an economic collapse. They see that there's no jobs, despite the fact that the Bureau of Labor Statistics says we're at 5.4%.
Yeah.
Even though we have 93 million people who aren't counted. Do they not have jobs? 93 million people aren't even counted.
Well their calculation, like how they come up with the number, I think is ridiculous anyway, because shouldn't it be what's the percentage of people that are unemployed? And I understand some people aren't looking for jobs or don't want to work, but you know, wouldn't that be a more accurate comparison if you're always looking at, okay, whatever, 40% are under are not employed or something?
Of course, it'd be accurate. But you know why the government downplays the real rate of inflation? Because if they had to admit the real rate of inflation, price inflation, that means that it would cost the government probably about $30 to $50 billion every year, because things like Social Security and pensions and benefits, those go a cost of living allowance based on the rate of inflation.
Yeah,
so they keep the inflation down so low, as a complete lie, so they don't have to pay these costs that mandatorily by law they're supposed to pay. So there's not a single thing that comes report that comes out of the government or a government-based agency that is accurate. It's all used to either make the current administration look better, or it's done to for some monetary reason, like the gross domestic product.
Well, if printing money didn't matter, and some people actually will say this, you know, you'll hear this, and it's usually people, you know, that call themselves progressives or socialists or whatever, that will say, well, it's not like, you know, your household bills where you have to balance your budget. But obviously, if it didn't make a fucking difference if you printed more money, then why tax anybody? Why not just print the money then if you need it?
But see, there's a big difference, and I'll tell you what the difference is.
Exactly. Then that's my point.
If the government was simply printing the money and it wasn't backed by anything, that's one thing. And the economy would be better off for it. But we have to pay interest to a private corporation to do the same thing, printing the money. So what we're doing is not only are we printing the money and causing the inflation rate to go up and the monetary supply to go up, but then we have to pay somebody just to give us the money back, to lend us the money back.
Yeah, but
if we get rid of the central bank and have the Treasury just print out the money without interest, then the economy would work relatively fine.
Yeah, but you'd still have the same supply and demand issue with the value of the dollar
true.
As well.
But one, it wouldn't be as extreme, and two, we used to have paper money all the time. You know, if you take a look at those old silver and gold certificates from the 1930s, we used paper money. All we did was we changed the value of gold and silver. See, that's how you get away with it. Okay. That's what China's going to do when they go to a gold-backed system, is you base currencies according to the value of gold. So if you end up printing more money because you need to increase your monetary supply to pay off debt or to deal with growth in your economy, then your currency, aka the dollar in this king, is going to buy less gold. So the price of gold and dollars will go up because you're doing your currency tied to gold. Right now, all currencies are tied to the dollar. So as the dollar keeps getting printed, the people who are really feeling it are everybody else in the world who has to buy dollars at a devalued dollars with their currency to buy oil and commodities in the world market. So they're getting exported inflation.
Yeah,
we're
not
seeing it
as that before.
I mean, think about it. We've got so much money. We've got 16 to 18 trillion dollars out there in the world. Only 30% is here in the United States. Only 30% of that 18 trillion is here in the U.S. in our own monetary system. The rest of it is out in the world. So if our prices, what you see for food and gas and all that, are going up with just having 30%, what happens when the world dumps it all back at us?
Well, that's what we had talked about right before, that's where the danger is right now. It's exported, you know, outside the United States. But when it's no longer the reserve currency, that's when it's going to come back to, you know, destroy the value of the dollar here.
That gets back to why they want to have a war on cash and get rid of cash. OK, because When they're ready to devalue the currency, all they have to do is change the percentage of your deposit on a bank in electronic form. If they have to deal with all the cash, They've got to have people turn it in. They've got to, you know, and people are going to just ignore and they're going to just transact on the black market. It's probably why Louisiana passed its law. It's foreseeing that most people don't trust the banks, don't trust the government, don't trust the system, so they're just doing their own economy, you know, within themselves, cash for secondhand goods.
So, but going back to Jade Helm, a couple of things I wanted to mention from when a show I did a couple of weeks ago when we talked about it, but this also, and you may be aware of this or not, but it's all special forces. This is not like just the, you know, and I don't know all about the structure of the military, but I mean, this is like Green Berets and Navy SEALs, and it's specific to special forces.
Right.
And one of the things, and I don't know if he, because I have two clips, I don't know if he said it in the one I played and if you caught that or not, but I'm kind of going back to my notes that I had from a couple of weeks ago, and that it's about unconventional warfare is what their focus is.
Right.
It's just, you know, and again, when you look at all these things, even just from what they're saying, and again, I don't believe, you know, the bullshit that they put out there. But even if you just base it off of that, to me, it's pretty fucking disturbing in itself.
Well, it is disturbing. And, you know, like I said, I think we've hashed over the fact that it is disturbing. Two, it's against the law. Three, people are really looking into it and asking why. And four, if we really needed to train about urban warfare, we've been in Afghanistan and Iraq for, what now?
10-plus years? Yeah, I mean, it's been a while.
If the military isn't trained on this already in, you know, overseas in their battles, what are they going to learn domestically amongst us?
Right, nothing.
They're not going to. Special forces means you've already been in combat and you've already learned these things on the fly while you were in combat. You don't need to learn it domestically. No. I mean, what's the old saying? If it smells like a duck, quacks like a duck,
yeah,
you know, looks like a duck. What do you think it is?
So, yeah, I mean, so I don't think, at least in my opinion, and again, who am I, but I think it's pretty obvious that there's a lot of other reasons for this. And, you know, one of them you had mentioned is potentially preparing for a financial collapse, whether it's just in preparation, whether it's they actually think it's going to happen during that time or what. But I, you know, you look at all these things that happen, and we've talked about it, you know, a lot of stuff over the past few months, and how people just seem to be just like, well, whatever, it's just a military operation. And you know, again, even basing it off of what they're saying, I just can't see how people are not, you know, outrage, like, what the fuck is this?
Let me say something else straight out. The one of the questions was, or they mentioned that we have coordinated with local law enforcement and local agencies here. Well, guess who else the federal agencies worked with at Sandy Hook? Do you remember the main speaker? Was that fat sheriff or that fat...
the guy who fucked up, like, what he said, like, five times,
yeah,
or something. Yeah.
The federal agencies were working with the local PD, the local PD there, and the whole thing was a sham. They willingly lied about the whole thing, okay? So when the military or a federal agency comes to the local law enforcement and tells them, this is what's going to happen, and it's secret, and you can't tell what's really going to happen, or you will be thrown in prison and indicted, what are they going to do? they're gonna keep their mouth shut, and they're just gonna go along with the party. Okay, now I have no inside information. I don't know what the whole gist of this is. What all we have to do is, all we can do is put together pieces. There were exercises going at the same time Boston Marathon massacre occurred. There were exercises going on the same time 9/11 occurred. Now there's going to be a massive exercise that has never happened before, using military tanks, MRAPs, and the whole nine yards, not on military bases, but inside five different states.
Well, again, it's like nine states.
Yeah, well, perhaps nine states. The primary is
it's,
five.
Texas is the main base of operation, but it was, okay, because I had this from before. Texas, California, New Mexico, Arizona, Nevada, Colorado. But again, I did read somewhere somehow they opted out. But as you kind of mentioned, I don't know how they could opt out unless they're not going to cooperate somehow or something. Right. Utah, and then Florida and Mississippi are kind of like some little things going on there. But the main states are all the, you know, states in the Southwest, which we both happen to be in.
What's the primary conclusion you get from that? All border states. All states on the southern border. Period. I mean, Utah's a little bit off, but still, you're talking the Southwest,
yeah,
or the border.
And, Colorado's a little higher up, but yeah, I mean, they're all connected.
They're also in reference. They're mostly red states. They're mostly strong Second Amendment states. So, you know, you got to put a lot of things together. And I, like I said, I'm not doing this to fearmonger, but it is extremely disturbing when we are heading into a time when so many economists, experts, you know, as a matter of fact, Bill Holter's dropped some interesting things. We might not even make it to September, and that's why this is so vital. Over the past 10 days, first in Europe and then in Asia, we had two credit flash crashes in the bond markets. The bond markets in Germany, the German Bund, the equivalent of the U.S. Treasury, their German bond was at 5 basis points in interest. I mean, that's 0.005, 5/100ths of a, or 0.05, 5/100ths of a percent. Within 10 days, because of the credit crisis, because of the lack of liquidity, no cash available for the banks, it jumped up to 0.758 basis points. A rise of 140% or 1400% in that short a time is like a meteor heading straight to Earth, and we can't stop it. It's an impossibility unless there is an event that is, you know, just collapsing the system. So they were able to stave it off because the European Central Bank took a lot of their QE money and just saturated the bond market and sufficed it for now. But you can only do this so many times, and they're going to run out of right. liquidity. And this happened twice in the last 10 days. So the credit markets are collapsing. By the way, what was the 2008 collapse called? It was called the credit crisis, the 2008 credit crisis, because we're seeing the exact same thing. You can print all the money in the world, but if there's no capital to purchase with that money, then the money's worthless. And that's the problem is they've got all this money, but it's going nowhere. What banks are doing is they're borrowing money from the central banks. They're buying treasury bonds or government bonds, which means that the money is just sort of parked away. It's not in use. The government's doing whatever it wants with it, but it's not in use. Corporate bonds, the corporations are using it. But the banks are not lending any money to small businesses to grow the economy. They're not lending any money to people to buy houses. You can have housing starts, but the mortgage, the percentage of people who are actually fulfilling a mortgage are down about to pre-housing, you know, to housing bubble time.
Is any of that, maybe not the houses, but maybe that factors into it as well, but you definitely see but this has been going on for years, where you have corporations are controlling everything, where, you know, mom and pop shops and all that. I mean, you barely find any except, you know, the biggest, I think, is like restaurants. Like maybe you find, you know, independently owned restaurants and stuff like that. But how many department stores do you find, or, you know, other types of businesses that maybe 30 years ago you'd have a lot of them? So, I mean, do you see any connection between the banks, you know, only wanting to deal with the big corporations and the big companies to kind of get everybody else out?
No. The reason they're doing it is one reason only. You have just put $12 to $30 trillion into the system. If that money hit the general economy, i.e. through capital loans from the banks, you would have instant price inflation where we'd reach hyperinflation. So what they have to do is, if we're going to stay, you know, keep the banks solvent by printing all this money, you have to keep the money from getting down into the general economy. You're keeping it all into the stock markets, the bond markets, the banks, and that. The money's just not getting down to the general economy. That's where you get into liquidity crisis, because if all of a sudden all these countries, and that's what's going to happen, that's where you're going to get this, is all these people who bought these sovereign bonds and these corporate bonds, and when they're, think about this, the Swiss are now selling their bonds at negative interest rates. That means that you have to pay them to buy their bonds.
That's,
who in their right mind is going to do
insane.
That?
Right.
No retailer like us, mom and pop, or, you know, for our retirement or annuities, we're not going to buy this. So the only ones who are buying it are sovereign governments. They're cycling the money around at the top, moving it from one balance sheet to another just to stave off insolvency. That's what's happened. But the way to do this is, the more money they print, the more bonds they have to buy, the more they accumulate. If you've got equity, a mass amount of equity, a supply of equity that is far beyond the market could ever handle, what happens if you have no sellers? I mean, no buyers to what you're selling? The price will instantly fall through the floor. And
well,
that's what we're starting to see, is there are no buyers for this junk.
Well, that's where, you know, and you know, again, I'm far from a, you know, even close to an expert on, you know, the economy or what's good investments and things like that. But to me, it's just common sense where, you know, I want a fucking tangible asset that's worth something. I will not touch anything besides that. And that, you know, because everything is speculation. Whether it's stocks, whether it's, like, even you're saying, how, you know, houses. Well, you have equity in your house because the market says somehow that your house is worth this amount of money. But it's only worth that if someone's willing to fucking pay for it.
Well, true.
At that price.
But, you know, something you asked at the beginning when we started talking in the program, you know, I think we both came to the realization that the inevitable is inevitable. You really can't stop it. So how do you protect yourself?
Right.
And perhaps maybe that's what we should, you know, talk about going forward for whatever time we have left.
Well, I want to just real quick go through some of the stuff with Jade Helm, some of the notes I put together, nothing too detailed, and then just get your opinion on how you think this relates to the other stuff. And then definitely go into that, because I think it's important to look at that as well. Is really, you know, it just seems like a desperate, like, you know, no-win situation here. But so let me just mention a couple of the things that you might be aware of them anyway. But just You know, so if the listeners aren't aware of them, and then to get your kind of opinion on how you think that may relate to everything else that's going on. And as we've talked a lot in the past, is how things are so interrelated, where you can't really look just at one thing by itself, because it's usually, you know, something that's a result of something else or somehow interlinked with, you know, not maybe just one thing, but a whole bunch of things. So let me just go through this real quick. So as I mentioned, it's all special forces, which seems, you know, kind of strange to me, even on that, where, you know, Green Berets, Navy SEALs, Air Force Special Ops, Marines. We talked about all the states that they're in. And as you had mentioned, a lot of the states, the majority of the land is owned by the federal government, whether that is part of the rationale in using those states or not, who knows. But they also, one of the things, I think they kind of mentioned this in the speech, but they are, and I mentioned it briefly as well, they're using a lot of people's property. So they're saying that they're doing this ahead of time. So they're making an agreement to say, well, I'm going to use, you know, your farm or your this or your that. Like, they're having meeting places. It's very strange. The DEA and the FBI, as I mentioned, are working with them as well. And then they specifically mentioned Arizona. That was just kind of out of nowhere. That was very strange to me as well, that, oh, well, they're going to help us question people at the airport. That maybe he was just caught off guard there. I don't know. They talked about the operation being between, and not all of this is from that speech, but just other research as well, between like 11 at night and 4 in the morning. But then they kind of contradict themselves to say that, you know, you could end up seeing them or not. It's supposed to be from July. I got some different dates in there, but July 15th to, there was one where they said to September 11th, which was kind of strange, where it just, you know, and as we talked about earlier, kind of these dates and things like that, and it's just weird. Well, September 11th.
I think the most important thing to remember in all this is not the details or the semantics, but the fact that they're going to be out there for 2 months, but once they're out there, there is nothing, not a darn thing, that will keep them from extending it if something occurs.
Right. So, I mean, what I guess, and again, they're going to use large areas of undeveloped property from people. Their plain clothes supposed to blend in, but then they're not. Just all this different stuff. But so, I mean, what, and again, of course, this is just speculation. I mean, what do you think the main goal is here? And I would say there's probably multiple goals. You know, you mentioned the financial aspects and the possible financial collapse, but what other things do you think, or what other goals do you think they have in mind in doing this?
Oh, I couldn't tell you what goals they have in mind. I mean, anything outside of that is pure speculation. But what you've got to do is you've got to take what they say, what they're doing, and then try to relate it to what could potentially be a trigger point. ISIS just 8 miles outside Texas, if that's true. The economic collapse that's coming.
Speaking of that, because you brought that up earlier as well, is that, and I read the article, and even their sources were pretty, not very, it didn't seem very reliable. And it to me, it sounds like a bunch of bullshit. If anything, it sounds like, you know, a bunch of people, you know, 10, 15 guys in a garage that said, hey, we're part of ISIS. I mean, how much validity do you even put into
Well, it depends on the sources. I've heard some of this stuff coming out from, you know, big papers like the New York Times. And anything that's the mainstream media is controlled. They don't print anything that the government doesn't want them to print. Secondly, ISIS was created by the U.S. government. Going back to the Mujahideen, to Al-Qaeda, when they wanted them to take out Assad. And that's where ISIS came from.
Yeah.
I mean, think about it.
It's all U.S. government.
You know who the leader of ISIS is? The former defense minister under Saddam Hussein. ISIS does not get created if we don't go into Iraq. Period.
Yeah, so and that brings up another point too, that supposedly they got all these weapons because they got them from Iraq, and it's just
let me give you if we were you ever heard of a gentleman named Craig Hewlett? Craig B. Hewlett? If anybody wants to go out and Google him, this guy has worked with federal agencies, all of them, military, local law enforcement, intel. He's been hired to do scenarios and breakdowns. He does a lot of training with them. This guy is an insider of insiders. Okay, he's on Coast to Coast AM all the time. He's one of their experts. Craig Hewlett said this: if we really wanted to get rid of ISIS, they'd be gone in 2 weeks. They're not that coordinated. They're not that organized. The only reason that they're even allowed to exist is because of the propaganda factor to keep war in the Middle East going. Here's the thing. Did you see the other day when they went into Ramadi? When they took Ramadi in Iraq, they had these convoys going like miles. They were celebrating, firing weapons. They're all standing out there. Two drones could have taken out the entirety of ISIS. Where was the United States intelligence? If we wanted to get rid of them, we could have gotten rid of them right there. They were stretched out in a convoy for miles. We could have destroyed their entire infrastructure, but we didn't. And they took Ramadi.
That was my whole story. Thing about, you know, Mexico and not being that close, and I'm actually getting married in El Paso too, so that's nice, but I think it's a bunch of bullshit anyway. But that was my whole point there too. Couldn't they, you know, if they really wanted to get rid of what, to me, if it even exists, I would think it's some little fucking shack. But why don't they just drop a couple bombs on there? They don't have any problem dropping bombs all over the place, every place else.
Well, they could, but having them there allows them the false flag possibility.
Well, that's my point. If they're there, it's because they want them to be there.
There you go. Answered the question. Yep, exactly. There's not a single thing we can trust from anything that comes from the mainstream media or from the government. They're synonymous. They're the same thing. As a publisher, as an editor over on a major German newspaper, I think it was Der Spiegel, said that we had the CIA come in, and there's not a single thing that we print, and we've had stories given to us that we were ordered to print. Every mainstream media is pretty much bought up by the corporations. The corporations are tied into the government. It's called fascism. They work hand in hand. That's what we have.
Well, and they were able to, you know, create this whole system of, well, if you're doubting any of this stuff, you know, you're just some fucking conspiracy theorist nut, because,
you know where the term conspiracy theory came from?
It was the Kennedy assassination.
Yeah, but even before, when after World War II, when we brought in a lot of the Nazi scientists and they started doing MJ or MK Ultra.
The mind control stuff, yeah.
Mind control. Anybody who questioned it, they coined the phrase conspiracy theory as a means to vilify anybody who questioned what they were doing. It was a psyops. The term conspiracy theory was created in its current form in the 1960s as a psyops to try to dissuade anybody from listening to whistleblowers. So even today, when you use it, you know, as George Bush goes, let's not listen to conspiracy theories. That was about 9/11. He's trying to cut it off in the bud. Don't go looking too much into 9/11. You might actually find something you don't want to find.
Well, you had Obama did the same thing at a Ohio State graduation where, you know, he said, well, you know, those people that are talking about tyranny around the corner and blah, 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 you know, don't listen to them.
Right.
Who the fuck would say that?
When you drop a term like that, a psyops term, and then you have the media, then you tell the media, anybody that we tell you to, you write articles and you make them out to look like they're just an idiot and, you know, and stupid conspiracy theorists, you know, and then you have the stories about, oh, look at, who is it, Sirhan or whatever, you know, he was a nut job who would always buy Catcher in the Rye books and yada. The thing about it is disinformation is just as good as misinformation. Because
right.
You muddy the water so much that people are just throw up their hands. I don't want to listen. I don't want to hear anymore. I don't know what to believe.
Well, I think
that's what's happened.
I think even leaving out information as well. And when I say leaving out, like the stories that are covered. So not even just the part that maybe you sway a story or something like that, but just what you choose to cover and what you choose not to cover, I think makes a huge difference as well.
Just look at the nightly news.
Yeah, so there's all this stuff that they just don't talk about.
You don't even get a single thing. You don't even get a single thing of value. But that's where most people get their news. They get home from a long day of work. They're tired. They just want the basics. They grew up in an era when everybody trusted Walter Cronkite. And you know, and they don't. Maybe on the weekends they'll read the paper and they'll read. But even the paper, anything of substance is like on D20.
It's
not front page anymore.
Yeah, and it's controlled. But I remember, and I don't like to say how old I am, so we'll say whatever. A while ago, well, maybe 10 years ago in college, where we because my bachelor's degree is in film and. We had this book about how, you know, I think at the time it might have been 10 major corporations owned, you know, 90% of the media. And it's not just, you know, people just think of media like, you know, TV and newspapers. I mean, it's TV, newspaper, magazines, you know, search engines, any type of media you can think of. And now it's even less. Now I think it's like 6. So, I mean, the fact that, you know, whether you're reading it in a newspaper or you're watching it on TV, you might get it a little more in a newspaper. But like you said, too, I mean, if you do, it's going to be, you know, no one's going to find it anyway.
Well, I'll take it one step further and give an example. Clear Channel likes to, you know, almost be like they're the Fox News of radio out there. Clear Channel, I believe, owns 56% of all radio stations. Clear Channel is a George Bush creation. He owns him and I think Mitt Romney own shares in the corporation that owns Clear Channel.
Yeah, and
story right there. This is why you have the Sean Hannitys and all the neocons who are on there talking war. You know, that's why you hear that dribble all day, because Clear Channel controls nearly all the talk radio, and they pretty much have all the other elevator music, you know.
And
the rest of the stations don't matter.
And that was the other thing I'm left out as well. When I was saying newspaper and TV, you know, radio also, any form of media is owned by these corporations. And I guess even there was something, I don't remember if it was in the book or there was some documentary, but nobody ever mentioned it. They did a Saturday Night Live skit on it once. And this is when, you know, GE owned NBC. And I don't know if, I know they sold it, but they might still own some stock. It aired once and then it pretty much just disappeared. you know, how the all these corporations owned it. And now, again, you know, it's even smaller. But I want to take a quick break. And then when we come back, you know, we can address what you wanted to talk about regarding, I guess, kind of how what really to do with all this information and how to, you know, I even kind of want to get into, because this is something that, you know, I think affects me as well, and I can get your thoughts on it also. But how this, you know, a lot of stuff like this can affect people, and I mean in a negative way, where, you know, we're talking about all these things that are going on and sitting there really saying, okay, well, we can try to prepare to an extent, but no matter what, you know, there's only so much you can do. And it is scary to an extent. So we'll take a quick break. When we come back, we'll be back with Kenneth Schortgen of the Daily Economist. And you can check us out, of course, at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. You can listen to the live stream there, as well as various archives. So we'll be right back after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com.
Tanks, guns, armor, all tried and tested on the battlefield. Now some of it is here in central Indiana on our streets being used to keep us safe. It's surplus military hardware that's found a new home.
Fox 59's Russ McQuay tonight shows us how some of our local police departments are now armed for war.
They're your tax dollars at work, and instead of being blown up, scrapped, or given away to a foreign country, surplus U.S. military hardware is coming home from the wars, being assigned to the streets and back roads of central Indiana to keep Hoosiers safe at a time of escalating homeland violence. The 1970s TV show SWAT showed state-of-the-art policing when heavily armed cops drove into danger in the back of what was essentially a bread truck. By 2010, for some police departments, not a lot had changed, as the Merrillville Police Department posted a video of its SWAT team in training, riding up to a scenario, clinging to the side of a Chevy Suburban. SWAT team commanders knew there had to be a better way. They've got one in Martinsville. An excess U.S. Army mine-resistant vehicle, an MRAP, cast off by the American military and parked at the Morgan County Sheriff's Department.
The value of the vehicle was $650,000. It didn't cost us any money at all. And at this current moment, with the paint and the graphics, we have roughly $2,000 in it.
Once it patrolled Afghanistan. Now it's an armored SWAT vehicle with windshields that can take a direct hit from a 50 caliber weapon, a gun turret up top, and the armor to protect at least a half dozen cops inside.
When I first started, we really didn't have the violence that we see today. The weaponry is totally different now than it was in the beginning of my career. Plus, you have a lot of people that are coming out of the military that have the ability and the knowledge to build IEDs and to defeat law enforcement techniques.
Morgan County Sheriff SWAT Commander Dan Downing says such a vehicle would have helped get deputies close the day they were fired at by a barricaded gunman in 2011, or would have provided safe passage for kids escaping Martinsville Middle School after a shooting.
And at the end of the day, it gives the guys the ability to go home safely. So no matter what the price tag is on it, as long as they get to go home, that's all that really matters.
That's why the police chief in Franklin has equipped his officers with excess M16s from the Pentagon stockpile.
If we go to a bank robbery, let's say, and we're just armed with our sidearm, we're going to be outgunned. And so we're trying to be proactive, not try to be scary, but we need to be able to be equipped as well as the bad guys sometimes, so to speak. So if they're going to be having assault rifles, we better have an assault rifle.
The man escapes out the side of the truck. As officers fire at him, he fires back. You see the rapidity with which the rounds are fired out of his automatic rifle.
That's what L.A. cops found out in February of 1997 when two armed and armored men loaded for bear and ready for war robbed a North Hollywood bank and went on a shooting spree, sending officers scrambling to gun stores to take rifles off the shelves in order to fight back. The Law Enforcement Support Office website offers guns and hazmat gear and clothing and night vision goggles to local police departments. And excess vehicles, too, like those parked out back of the Cumberland City Hall.
It's something that you don't use every day, but when you need it, you're darn glad that you got it. And so in the winter, somebody's stuck or we can't get into a place, they'll be happy, you know, that we're able to get in this one and get through.
You want to talk about a prudent use of your federal tax dollars. Not only does Chief Crook have this surplus military vehicle as part of the Cumberland Police Department on his force, he's got a trained military veteran who knows how to drive this vehicle and maintain it.
This is Congressman Hank Johnson.
Georgia Congressman Hank Johnson is worried about Pentagon spending, and small-town cops who have acquired helicopter parts and boats and bayonets and guns they don't need or can't keep track of, and he's ready to write clampdown legislation.
We have to actually record all serial numbers, take pictures of every weapon, every serial number, and then send that off to the military or whoever is there who wants the proof that we still have them and we didn't give them away, lose them, or sell them, or something crazy like that.
We have extensive inventories of what every law enforcement agency has, and when a new request is made, we compare those existing inventories to what their needs are, and based on those items, we either approve or deny their request.
When we were coming back from Mississippi with it, we were actually approached when we'd stopped to get fuel by people wanting to know why we needed this, what we were going to use it for. Are you coming to take our guns? I'll be the last person to come and take anyone's guns. That absolutely is not the reason that we got this vehicle. We got this vehicle because of a need and because of the increased violence that we've been facing over the last few years.
State officials say last year they got $14 million worth of free Pentagon hardware and materiel and guns that local law enforcement agencies could never afford. This year's savings are expected to nearly match that.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. Check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. We are here with Kenneth Schortgen, historian and expert on the economy and geopolitics. You can check him out at the Daily Economist as well as other sites, but the Daily Economist is the best place to go to get all of Ken's information. So Ken, one thing I just wanted to bring up briefly, and I don't know how accurate this is or whatever, was that, and this kind of relates to what we're going to talk about, but that they're trying to, they being the government, classify almost all ammunition as armor-piercing bullets. Have you heard anything about that? Or?
Yeah, I've heard the scuttlebutt about that. That's just Obama with going back to his promises of trying to get guns and out of everybody's hands. I don't think it's really going to go anywhere.
Okay, well,
because if you really think about it, the only way that they can do that is at the federal level, and most shootings are done at the state level. So state, until you start seeing states pass that law, I would just pretty much discount it.
So regarding, I guess, you know, what we were talking about at the beginning, and then what you wanted to get into before I went through some more of the Jade Helm stuff. I mean, what and we often kind of talk about stuff related to this as well, as, you know, where we talked about preparation and stuff like that. But I mean, what, you know, I guess is, I'll say, what's the solution here? But I mean, what are your?
There's really one solution. I want to preface what we go into. Obviously, what we've talked about, but I want to preface it with three things real quick. I wrote an article about a week ago that new statistics came out. Americans are renouncing their citizenship at record numbers. Last year, there was about 3,415 people who renounced their citizenship and repatriated outside the country. 3,415 for the entire year. So far in the first 3 months, the first quarter, there have been 1,335. That means you multiply that by four, you're going to get 5,200. You're going to get a nearly 60% increase.
So what do you think that – do you think it's something the government – will try to, I mean, it's still in the big scheme of things, yeah, it's a small number, but it is showing, you know, a pattern there. Do you think that at some point, and I know they've actually done this already where they're trying to make it harder, at least more expensive.
But they're
going to continue that?
They've jacked up the price to about $2,400 to give up your citizenship. They're doing capital controls. Matter of fact, there was a bill that was passed two and a half years ago in the transportation bill that if you owe more than $50,000 to the IRS, they take away your passport. You can't leave the country.
Yeah, I was aware of that.
This war on cash, this is something that they're afraid of. They're afraid of people taking their money out of the country, out of banks. Okay? And as a matter of fact, that was the first thing I wanted to talk about is how many people are repatriating. Now, this is just renouncing their citizenship. There's a ton of people because in places like Mexico or South America, you don't have to renounce your citizenship. You can actually take your passport, go down there, especially if you have a little bit of money and open a bank account, rent some property or buy some property. You can go 90 days or between 90 days and 6 months with your current visa. All you have to do is leave the country for like 3 days, go visit, you know, some other country like Costa Rica, Ecuador, Panama, or something like that. Then you come back in, they restamp your visa, and it's good for 60, 90 days again. And that's what people have been doing. They're just every 90 days, they'll go leave for a three-day weekend someplace, come back in. And yeah, so they're repatriating without renouncing.
I think that's what, I don't know if you're familiar with Jeff Berwick, who actually
Angel Clark and Jeff Berwick.
Yeah, because you're right, because they're both in Mexico. But
Acapulco.
I know that he had mentioned stuff like that before, that, yeah, you just leave and for a couple of days or, you know, take a vacation for a week and just come back and you're good.
That's what Dr. Jim Woolley does. He's lived in a number of different places now, down South America, Central America, and that's pretty much what he says. After about 90 days, go take a three-day vacation somewhere in another country, step across the border, come back 3 days later, you got a visa, you're good for whatever. It also allows you then to transfer from country to country to country and country with your passport. Sure, they'll know exactly, where you cross the border, but, how are they going to really search into some of the hinterlands in some of these places? So that's one thing that's going on. Something else that I can't remember.
Before you get to that, and I don't know how familiar you are with this, but I would think this anyway, that a lot of these other countries don't have the technology that the U.S. has anyway regarding, all the spy grid and all that stuff. So I would think even if they're trying to track you, and they can track you from your passport or whatever, but not the same way that the U.S. does with spying on everything you do and all of that.
No, but remember, all passports from like the last 5 years and forward, they have RFID chips.
They do have those now. Okay, yeah, because I got one in 2003, and it expired in 2013, and I haven't got another one since.
Right. Yeah, so the new ones are they'll be able to scan in and whatever country, and you'll be able to see that. The other thing I was going to do is I can't remember if I mentioned this on the show. This was this was from earlier this month. When Congress was, Congress has not passed a budget in like 6 years. They pass spending appropriation bills, but they have never passed a budget. All they do is whenever they need money, they just pass a new appropriations bill. Well, they use this bill as a means for Democrats and Republicans to throw in all their pet projects to hide it under
bullshit spending
bills. One of them is one that was put through that people are just going to say, what? Now, we may have talked about in the past, or at least I have on certain other shows, back right after the credit collapse of or credit crash of 2008, Nancy Pelosi, when she was Speaker of the House, came out and said that she wanted to see about passing a bill to nationalize all retirement funds, 401ks, pension funds, annuities, IRAs, mutual funds, et cetera. That didn't really go anywhere. But all of a sudden, in early May, when they passed the spending bill, there was a hidden rider in there that nobody really knew about, and it hardly ever hit the news. But they just did a confiscation of pensions for upwards of 10 million people. Within there was a it's regarding multi-employer union pension plans. Now, multi-employer union pension plans are something along the lines of, say you're an independent truck driver, and for 10, 15 years you drove for one company. Then for another 10 years you drove for another company. Each of the companies you drove for would have created a pension plan for you based on what the agreements between the company and the union. Because if you're a truck driver, you're still under a union, the same union, whether you work for company A or company B. So you've got two valid pensions. But according to this new law that was passed earlier this month, the government is now going to confiscate 60% of all your pension money if you have multi-employer pensions. So if you have two pensions, justifiable, that's unfair, and they're going to go ahead and confiscate 60% of it. Now, this only happens with private, and it's like I said, there's 10 million people in unions who this is going to happen to. In the public sector, it's a little bit different. If I join the military at age 18 and I go 20 years in the military, I'm going to get a military retirement right when I get out, if I retire right then and get out. But I'm going to be 38 years old. So I could either join the civil service, get a GS job working for the government. I could join the post office, which has a pension plan. So I work 20 years additional there. When I retire, I've got two pensions. The Congress is not going to touch anybody who is in public sector work, who has two pensions, who's double dipping. But the private sector, if you're not part of the public sector, they're going after your money. And they've already passed the law, and
just so I'm clear on this. So you're saying if you have government pensions, they're not going to go after it, but if you have private pensions, they are.
Right, multi-employer union pensions. So if you work for a union and you've got pensions coming in from more than one source, like say two or three companies you've worked for, they're going to automatically take off 60% of that.
Yeah, that's crazy. Well, I mean,
yep. So they're already starting to take retirement pensions. I just want to let people know that. So there's a war on cash. You at J.P. Morgan, you cannot pay off your debt obligations using cash. You can't store cash in safety deposit boxes anymore. They won't take it, and now they're taking pensions.
When you say they won't take it, you're talking about J.P. Morgan specifically?
Yeah. Yeah, you can't walk into J.P. Morgan, who you may have your mortgage, your home mortgage with, and pay your property taxes or your insurance or your mortgage payment with cash. They won't accept it.
Oh, right. Yeah, what you were saying earlier. Right. But I thought with safety deposit boxes able to.
They sent out a letter in March. Besides, you can't pay your mortgage in that, or student loans or auto loans with cash, they will not allow you to store cash in a safety deposit box anymore in their bank.
How would they even know? Isn't it supposed to be?
You sign a paper, and the government can go ahead and check it at any time, So anyway, like I said, if you've got money beyond what you do for your normal bill pay, if you've got money in a bank, I regret what's going to happen the moment that there's the next credit crisis, dollar collapse, or economic collapse. Instantly, your money is going to be confiscated, period.
Yeah,
they're already confiscating pensions. They don't want you to have cash anymore. And by going completely electric or electronic, they can take bail in your money in an instant, and you can't have any control.
And you know what else? Even thinking about, because they have a lot of, you know, and I don't know how trustworthy they are, but where you can get safety deposit boxes at, you know, non-financial institutions. I know one in Las Vegas is actually an anonymous, and you can do something where it's even like a retinal scan if you want, or you can, you know, have a key, whatever, but it's totally anonymous. I don't know how the payments work, because what happens if you don't pay?
You're probably going to pay more because they've got to provide you insurance that the banks before. The bank's insurance was a vault. You know, the cost is going to be in a private sector, you're going to pay more. So, but that's a great option. To tell the truth, that's a great option.
Well, but what I was saying was, like, the how you would pay, like, okay, say you get a safety deposit box, you pay for a year, and then how they get in touch with you so you can pay for the second year when they don't know who you are. But sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, but you know what? If you've got valuables or money in a safety deposit box, if they have to contact you to renew it, then you don't deserve the wealth anyway. You know, that goes back to what I was saying.
Well, the point is,
one of the reasons why the government takes over is because people have abrogated their independence and they're doing for themselves to other people.
Right.
Out of apathy, laziness, or whatever. You know, we are responsible for our assets, for our choices, for our actions, for our you know, whatever. If we aren't, then we cannot complain when somebody comes by and tells us what to do.
Well, it's the same thing as, you know, it's like government being a parent and people not being responsible for their choices and having to, I mean, to kind of, you know, just simplify it, I guess, is a lot of it is, and of course it goes beyond that because their motivation is not to, you know, help people or protect people. But yeah, I mean, with something like that, where you can go to a non-financial institution, have a safety deposit box, again, whether do it by a retinal scan or a key, or but even the retinal scan, it's anonymous until they have databases with people's retinal scans in them. So it protects you in a lot of ways because, you know, never mind the fact that you just don't want to keep your money in the bank for, you know, the purposes that you were talking about. But if you want to hide money, and how can they, you know, they can't sue you because as far as they know, the money doesn't exist. It's not in your name or anything like that. The thing that I would worry about is that what happens when you want to put a down payment on a house and then you pull out 20 grand in cash because you've been putting all your cash and, you know, storing it somewhere. And then the government's going to try to come after you and say, well, where'd you get this from? You probably didn't pay taxes on it.
Well, yeah. But, you know, the thing about it is even, you know, the exterior safety deposit box is a good idea. But we also are in a time of civil forfeiture. So if the government goes into that business and they don't have to charge anybody with anything, but they can say, we think the money and stuff in these security deposit boxes, because it's not in a bank, we think that it was involved in a crime and we're going to go in and just confiscate it. And it's up to the individual to prove that the money was not used in a crime.
Yeah, but that's a good point as well. I mean, you
getting back to whatever, there's, you know, we've hashed gold and silver, I think, and, you know, you probably talked about it, guests have talked about it, I've talked about it. If you haven't found that, or, you know, decided that you're going to get rid of your worthless fiat money to buy real money, I want to bring this in real quick before I get into some of the the idea of a potential for what people to do. This came out in late April. China, hints of gold use in their new free trade zones and along the Silk Road. This was from China Daily. In a report on the likely impact on the gold market, officials estimated that 65 countries along the new Silk Road and their combined 4.4 billion population, which currently account for more than half of the world's gold production and 80% of consumption. Here's the final thing. The gold trade is expected to become a significant component of transactions by Silk Road countries. 65 countries, 4.4 billion people, which is more than half, right here, the new financial system will be based on gold.
Well, and now, we had talked about, just to mention this again, that there was something that you were doing where you have a basically like a debit card backed by gold or whatever, and they store your gold and you know, that you can convert it instantly into cash and all that stuff.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I was going to go ahead and bring about again. Okay, I wanted to lay the foundation. They've already passed a law to confiscate forms of pensions. You know that with the government, once they start down that road, they're going to go for them all. There's a war on cash where banks don't want cash, and anybody who has cash, you're not, you know, they pretty much want you to get rid of it. The new financial center is coming out of China is going to be gold. Bill Holter already said that they're going to make an announcement that they have 30,000 tons. Once that happens, that's going to open the door instantly for most of the world to say, we don't want the dollar. We're willing to jump on and use the yuan or another basket of currencies for the global reserve currency system. It can happen overnight. We're already starting to see flash crashes in the credit markets. With this being said, if you want to be prepared, okay, anything you own, stocks, bonds, annuities, etc., they may be diversified paper assets, but the problem is they're all denominated in dollars. If the dollar goes, every single one of those assets are gone. So how do you protect yourself if the dollar collapses, if the euro collapses, if the ruble and yuan go under some pressure like they did when the sanctions came by or when the oil prices dropped? If people who are listening, after all what we've laid out, have come to the conclusion that the new monetary system is going to be based on gold and the price of gold, and that the price of gold in whatever currency is going to rise and fall depending on how much currency, you know, each country is going to do, that all trade coming from the Silk Road, from the new trade zones, from the AIIB bank, all these are going to be gold-backed. If gold is going to be the central thing, so you can either buy gold and silver, which, of course, the most difficult thing is going to be when you need to liquidate that gold and silver, how and where are you going to do it? Because if the monetary system goes down, the government's either going to say, we recognize gold and silver right now as collectibles, not as money. So if you sell it, we're going to tax it as collectible. As a matter of fact, we're going to tax it whatever. So they're going to tax it if you sell it here in the states.
Well, they do that now in certain states when you buy gold coins. I believe in Nevada, if you buy a gold coin, that they tax you on it.
Right. Well, actually, mostly when you sell. But they expect you to have the receipt because they'll expect it to be a capital gain. So if you bought in 2009 for $747 and you decided to sell it today for $1,250, then the difference between $749 and $1,250, which
is $500,
they're going to tax
on
that,
the income,
your earnings,
yeah.
Right, just as if it was a collectible. So the other question is if the financial system is you know, going through these straits, will coin dealers and those entities that sell gold and silver, are they even going to be open? They're not going to have access to banks. banks are going to be on holiday. Where are they going to get the cash to liquidate it for you? So you need to be able to have your money, your addition, you know, your fiat currency stored in metal that's going to be secure in value, and it's going to be the preparation for the new financial system. But you also have to be able to liquidate it at a moment's notice into any currency you want. And I mentioned the last show, this what? Company out of Germany called Carrot Bars.
Yeah.
And this is probably the most significant company, and it was created in 2011 out of Stuttgart, Germany. They own, this year, they purchased their own gold mine. So they already, all the gold they sell is coming out of their own mines. They have an agreement with MasterCard, and we'll get to that in a moment, how that all works. The company is also a business opportunity, an affiliate marketing company. So if you have other people that you get to join Carrot Bars, if you're a member, you get to join Carrot Bars. Anytime they pay gold, you get a commission free. And unlike most affiliate marketing or network marketing companies, you do not have to do an automatic monthly auto ship. You don't have to buy anything you don't want to, which is much different, you know, where they make you buy monthly. And the greatest thing about it is you're not losing any money. You're taking money, dollars, to buy money, gold. So at the end of the day, you're getting commissions for buying money. Now, you can either have the gold delivered directly to you. You can have it stored for free at their vaults offshore. And here's one of the biggest kickers, the important factors, one of the perks. Carrot Bars is not a bank, so they are not required to report to the IRS under FACTA laws. Like every single bank, like the Swiss banks, have to report all their American clients and all their money. Carrot Bars doesn't. It's not a bank.
Just real quick, isn't that a recent law now that any bank account, any foreign bank account that any American citizens have has to be reported to the U.S. government?
That is correct. Within the last year. And the way that, and for the banks who tried to mess with it, the United States just said, fine, we won't sell you any dollars. We'll remove your credit line, your swap line. You won't be able to work through the BIS. You can't buy dollars to buy oil. That's how they forced all the banks to do this. When the banks suddenly were like, you know what, we rely too much on the Fed to borrow money from their discount window. Screw you, customers. You know, screw you, American customers. We don't even want to deal with you. So Carrot Bars is a corporation, a German corporation that is in 120 countries. As a matter of fact, Americans have lost their knowledge of the value of gold and silver so much, but you know what? The rest of the world hadn't. China, India, Indians been buying it for thousands of years. And let me give you an example of a country that saw the potential of Carrot Bars. They now have 10.5% of their entire population in this country, either a customer or a affiliate business builder in Carrot Bars. And that's the island of Aruba. Now, most people know Aruba as Natalie Holloway and that murder thing, whatever. There are 102,000 people on Aruba. 11,000 are either customers or affiliates of Carrot Bars. It makes up 5% of their gross domestic product. Carrot Bars does, just for the island of Aruba, and that's just one of 120 countries. There are three vaults around the world that Carrot Bars has that gold can be stored at. So if one country starts, you know, getting down, they can always move and transfer the gold to someplace else. But here's the kicker. Many people today listening or whatever have PayPal or a similar type account. You know, sort of like Bitcoin, we have an e-wallet. Right.
And if you don't have PayPal, you can get it in like 2 minutes or something.
Right. And PayPal has a thing now where you can get a credit card to be able to, so whatever money comes into your PayPal account, you can upload it like a preloaded debit card. If you buy a gift card from a grocery store, have it preloaded with money, and you can just spend it as a debit or credit card. PayPal has that. Well, guess what? Carrot Bars does too. And they have an e-wallet that is the equivalent of a virtual offshore bank account. You can, once you earn 20 euros in commissions, or you can buy it outright for 45 US dollars. They have a connection with MasterCard, okay? That MasterCard, which is recognized not only around the world, but in any currency. So if the dollar goes kaput, you can use your MasterCard and demand in whatever currency in the world. It doesn't matter. So what you can do is you can actually take the money in your bank. You can preload it to your MasterCard. You can wire it to your bank, offshore bank account, your e-wallet. And it's outside the purview of any regulatory body because they are not by law have to report, and they are by law not a bank. So they, you know, you can't just send in a subpoena to grab somebody's account. So you can, what you can do then is you can either take your money and buy gold, store it in their vaults, and if you need to liquidate it for cash at a moment's notice, you go into your account, your e-wallet's right there, you transfer it, you sell the gold with a click of a mouse, they will transfer it into euros, that money will be preloaded onto your MasterCard, you can spend it in the U.S. in dollars. That's how you work between gold and any currency, is you store it in gold, you liquidate it whenever you need into whatever currency, and it's all on one card. And you can be anywhere in the world. So those people who have repatriated, as Jeff Berwick and Angel Clark have done, they live in Acapulco. They can have a Carrot Bars account or business. They can walk around with a MasterCard. It works in pesos. It works in any currency. Any earnings that they do, they can upload it to their e-wallet and then buy gold and store it. Their wealth is protected. It's liquid, which is the very definition of money, to be able to use it fungible and accepted anywhere around the world. So, and the thing about Carrot Bars is that if you there are seven different ways to make money with Carrot Bars. There's a dual system if you buy a commission package, which the silver package runs between $350 and $400 depending upon the fluctuation in the price of gold, because you actually get gold when you buy the package. Or you can just be a customer and you're on the unit level, and anybody you sign up who buys gold, you get a commission on, you get units, and it goes automatically into your thing. They cycle through your units weekly, and any commissions automatically get put into your debit card. You don't even have to think about it. So I know some people. This company was vetted by somebody who I work with over at RogueMoney.net. He went over to Germany. He saw the vaults. He met the CEO. He looked at all their books. And he signed up. He's a affiliate member. I'm signed up under him. So this is not something that we're promoting without doing ourselves. And there are people who are making $75,000 a week, because if you know two people who are interested and want to be business builders, that's the thing about the dual system program. You find two, you teach them to find two, and within 7 weeks, you're making about $3,450 a week. And you can have that stored in gold. You can spend it as you see fit in your MasterCard. Your monetary system or monetary future is already set, because you are prepared in what right now appears to be the next financial system, a gold-backed currency, a gold-backed trading platform. You're protected in case the dollar collapses. You're protected in case the euro collapses. You're protected in case every single currency in the world implodes, because your wealth is stored in gold. And whatever comes out of it is going to be gold-backed, and you're already prepared for whatever currency is going to rule the day.
Yeah, no, definitely. And I know we had talked about that the last time, and it's similar in a sense to Bitcoin, with the exception of the fact that I'd mentioned this before, that my issue with Bitcoin was always the fact that it's a fiat currency. It's just it's not a tangible asset. And with, you know, gold and silver, it is. So that was always something, thinking of, you know, the downside to gold and silver is, you know, you can't carry around a whole bunch of, I mean, I guess you can, but it's not ideal to carry around a whole bunch of gold and silver, you know, in your pocket or whatever. And, you know, for something like that to essentially have a gold and silver debit card that you can convert as you need it, you know, I think is a pretty, you know, good thing to have.
Yeah. And the thing about it is to me, the big difference between Bitcoin and something like this is most of the world's retailers do not accept Bitcoin. You're going to be limited in that. Plus the fact that if the banking system is down or the electronic system in any way is hindered, because most of the servers that propagate Bitcoin are scattered throughout the world. You don't know the geopolitical situation wherever. If retailers do not accept Bitcoin, and in a currency collapse, most retailers are going to have a difficult time because their systems are not built to accept Bitcoin. But MasterCard is used anywhere around the world. Everywhere around, every retailer, every grocery store, pretty much anywhere in any currency. So it's not a matter of figuring out which currencies which don't do this. You're just transferring, or you're using a MasterCard, and the company itself will make the conversions for whatever currency you're using. And if anybody wants to learn more about that, go to thedailyeconomist.com, and I've written some articles that transition both news that's going on, the war on cash, and the pension information. And then I put all the information about carrot bars, and there's even a place to sign up if you're interested.
Yeah, and I actually, on the last show, I put it in the event on Facebook, so I'll add that as well. So it's in there. But yeah, I mean, I definitely think that, and maybe this is partially just me, but I still can't get past the fact of having a currency that is not worth anything, or at least represents something that's worth something. So, like, you know, we had talked about before that even, you know, say having gold in a bank and then them verifying that the gold is there and writing some kind of whatever, some note that represents your gold. But to just have fiat currency, just currency that just is not backed by anything other than, you know, I know there's the list of, okay, if it meets this criteria, but I just can't get beyond that concept of, okay, this is not backed by a tangible asset. It's meaningless to me. I mean, it obviously, I get paid in U.S. dollars and I'm not going to give it away and say, oh, this is meaningless, here you go. But I mean, just the fact that something is, it's not based on anything. It's literally just paper, you know, printed from however, you know, they run the fucking printing machines or whatever, as opposed to representing some kind of tangible asset.
Well, that's the power of programming. We, you know, up until 1964, our coins had silver in them. Up until 1971, our dollars were gold backed. And we've had 45 years and two generations to make people forget what it means to have a currency backed by precious metals. The rest of the world did not forget this, but the West did, and the West did it on purpose so they could expand the monetary supply. Now, the concept of using fiat currency or any type of currency, back in the Roman days, you know what they used to pay the Roman legionnaires in? Salt.
No, it's worth something, I guess.
Yeah, because salt was so valuable that they gave them a certain measure of salt. This is where the term salary comes from. The term salary is derived from salt. So the ancient Mayans, they built their temples and that with gold, but they didn't use it as a currency. What did they use as a currency? They used cocoa beans. Some ancient Fiji Islands use shells. It doesn't matter as long as there's confidence by the people in a certain monetary instrument.
Right.
For now, we're programmed to trust in fiat currency. But
it's a false confidence. Go ahead.
But that confidence is falling, and the world is rejecting it. We've had 44 years of an entire world based on a purely fiat currency backed by nothing. The world is rejecting it, and we're not going to see it again. Okay, so this is like a period in time that you and I and everybody else has lived through that the world saw it went to pot, and it's not going to happen again. So we're going back to a gold standard of some sort. So we can say that we don't like the current fiat currency system, and it's going away. And it's going to be a blip on the historical radar when all is said and done.
So, I mean, we had talked before, and maybe based on some of the Jade Helm schedule there, that you may even think this is going to be even sooner. But, you know, we had talked, and again, it's all speculation, but you know, by October or somewhere by the end of the year, that you think the U.S. dollar is pretty much going to collapse at that point. Has anything changed in your mind, or one way or the other, that it won't even last that long, or that maybe there's some things that they can still do to try to just prolong the inevitable?
They could try to extend it, but here's one of the most important things that we have to remember from the 2008 credit crisis and the concept of too big to fail banks. Okay, back in 2008 we saw two banks sacrificed. Actually, we saw three. We saw Bear Stearns, we saw Lehman Brothers, and we saw AIG. One was an insurance company. Lehman Brothers was sacrificed because they held all the silver derivatives for J.P. Morgan, and J.P. Morgan had to buy it out, take it over, to protect themselves from going insolvent. AIG was bailed out so that the government could bail out Goldman Sachs, which was the real insolvent bank, paying off their instruments at 100 cents on the dollar, where everybody else got whatever.
Wasn't AIG the company that was insuring all the derivatives or whatever that?
Oh, yeah. Exactly. And so since you had a credit crisis and a credit collapse, you had a derivative crisis. And so AIG had no money to pay off all these derivative bets.
Right.
So you have that. Well, what they did was the Fed said, you know what? We're going to make a choice. We can't afford to have a single bank like Lehman Brothers or Bear Stearns fail, because if that fails, then everybody starts collapsing in a domino like it did. So they, back in the shipping days, the pirate ship days, whatever, it was called lashing all the ships together, or lashing all the banks together. So now every bank is too big to fail. Even the smallest ones are too big to fail. What it really says is that if one goes down, they all go down. But it's going to take something massive for even the first one to go down. We're seeing banks reach that point. And you have to remember, these nations already know what's coming about. January 2014, 120 nations got together and signed a treaty to do a global currency reset. They signed the treaty to do the currency reset. Why? Because they already know that they're insolvent. The U.S., though, thought they could kick the can down another 2 years, and they so far have. But the inevitable has already come. You kick a can down the road, eventually you run out of road, or the can gets squashed. So everybody's preparing for that day. And it's not just me. You can go out there. You can see Jim Willey, Bill Holter, Peter Schiff, Gerald Celente, Jim Rickards. The list goes on. Martin Armstrong. By September, October this year, a lot of people are putting their reputation saying the collapse is going to happen. It may not be the dollar per se, but it's going to be the credit markets. It's going to be the stock markets. It's going to be the bond markets. It's going to be currencies itself. It's going to be something. And it's going to cause everybody all along the chains, dominoes. Japan, it's going to probably start in Asia. Japan now has a national debt of over one quadrillion yen. Our national debt is 18 trillion. 1 quadrillion yen.
What's the equivalent of U.S. dollars of that?
I think it's like 12 or 14 trillion U.S. dollars for an economy that's about one-fifth the size of the U.S.
Yeah, that's a lot smaller. Yeah.
Yeah. So we already have Japan that is pretty much toast. We have the Eurozone that is looking at a Greek exit. They had two flash crashes over the past 2 weeks in their liquidity market. The ECB is pumping out money like there's no tomorrow. Britain is already talking about with their new government pulling out of the Eurozone. Everything is starting to fall apart. Anything could collapse these things.
You know,
that's why now's the time to be prepared, because it doesn't matter. You can't predict who's going to come out ahead or who's going to win. The only thing you can predict on is what is a secure hard asset that I can both use for now and for whatever comes out of the future.
Yeah, and that's why I won't fuck with anything except for gold. I do have a 401k at work only because I have matching, but I'm going to, as soon as I know that I can keep my matching, I'm just going to keep pulling it out and pay the fucking tax penalty and I'll still make money. But the other thing I wanted to mention real briefly is they have these, and I'm looking into getting at least a small one, solar power generators. And I don't know how familiar you are with those, but there's a bunch of solar power generators on the market that, are relatively cheap. I mean, well, I wouldn't call it $1,000 cheap, but I mean, for a generator that can, power a number of things, it's not going to power your whole house.
Right.
Things like that are out there. So I'm looking into that. But it's really, again, when you think about all this stuff, I mean, how do you even just move forward and say, well, I know this is going to happen eventually. This is, about all I can do about it and still be able to, deal with a lot of that stuff.
You got to recognize that the world has gone through these cycles. It's funny is I heard this the other day. Somebody goes, have we ever had anything as big as the Great Depression? Oh, I remember. This was actually a quote to John Maynard Keynes. Well, I don't handle like his policies, but he was an intelligent person. Somebody asked him, he says, is there anything worse than the Great Depression? And he turned around and goes, the Dark Ages, 400 years of this. Throughout history, we have all had cycles. Every country, every nation, empire has risen and has fallen. World War II, my God, if it wasn't for the Marshall Plan, starvation would have just run rampant. There was no such thing as a banking system currency. People didn't have a place to sleep, place to eat. That was only 70 years ago. Okay, we have these things, cycles. The world, nothing in the world. Look at Katrina. People lost their entire livelihoods based on one storm. You cannot absolutely predict the future. You cannot make every decision based on your best logic. You can only prepare the best you can.
Yeah, but even – but
every contingency.
You know, like with that was a storm where they didn't know how bad it was going to be or something like that. And it's not just the issue, I think, and we only got a couple minutes, but is not just that, okay, you have the currency collapse. Even if you don't have a currency collapse, you have everything else that is going on regarding the government becoming essentially, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, you know, they're at the beginnings or even probably beyond the beginnings of where Nazi Germany was at. So, I mean, you have these things that are inevitable at the same time. So it's not just, well, okay, that you have the currency issue. You have all of these other things that are pretty much, as far as I see them, not only are they inevitable, but they're already all in motion, and there's already a bunch of things that are really fucked up already.
I'll give you a quick example of say they're able to stave off the system and it doesn't collapse and things change. Maybe they devalue all the currencies, but they keep them as they are. Well, people have to ask honestly. You may have a good job right now, but a lot of people, neighbors and that, they're either working two part-time jobs. They've been cut down to 30 hours thanks to Obamacare. There are 93 million Americans that we have that aren't working in the system, okay? The thought and concept that we may have to stay in the U.S. for the rest of our lives, if the jobs and industry are not here, we may have to go where they go. That could mean the Far East, in Europe, in the Eurozone. Everybody from every country can travel to wherever they go. You know, during the 1930s, when the Okies and Arkies, when the Dust Bowl came and their farms were gone, they traveled to California. You go where the jobs are. The world is changing. We're not limited to just being in America for whatever. We have to look at the livelihood. We have to look where the new industry is. The British Empire used to expand, the empire where the sun never set. They had offices in India. They had offices in China. They had offices all over the place. That eventually collapsed. Now they're part of the Eurozone, where Germany and France are much bigger economies than them. Russia is growing. They own all oil. China has the gold. India has the technology and the education, and they're pumping out more PhDs than we are in the United States. Industry has been offshored to Mexico, to Taiwan, to Vietnam, to China. We don't have anything here. There's going to come a certain point, and we're going to have to all realize that is, just as the Chinese came to the United States in the 1900s to build the railroads, and right, tens of thousands from all over the world came to the Panama Canal to build the Panama Canal, we can't think of ourselves necessarily as just America is always going to get by. Well, if the jobs aren't here, if the standard of living isn't here anymore, if the industry isn't here anymore, people are going to start leaving and going to where the jobs are. So you have to be able to function financially anywhere in the world.
Well, just like people from all over the world came here for a so-called better life, I guess it's kind of going full circle, and maybe that might be the opposite, where people from the United States are going to different countries in search of a better life at some point.
Yeah, just like the immigrants who came in the early 1900s, their parents and grandparents stayed in the old country, but it was the young people who wanted the jobs and wanted a future that left. It's going to be the same here. The baby boomers who are retiring are never going to leave, but the millennials are sitting here going, I've got $60,000 to $100,000 of student loan debt. I can't get a job. I'm not going to stay here.
Well, I guess the one positive is, you know, the more technology, the easier it is to work remotely if you're doing things like, you know, computer programming or website building or whatever, things
or columnist
like that.
Or a radio show host or a yeah, business owner. My mom built a business on the internet, a network marketing business 13 years ago. She's retired. She's making enough money each month to be retired. You can do this. If you see things differently, the paradigm is changing. The paradigm is shifting. There's a famous quote that I love more than anything else. It says the learners will inherit the earth. But the learned will suddenly find themselves beautifully equipped for a world that no longer exists.
All right. Well, on that note, that's about all the time we have left. And thanks as always, Ken. I always enjoy when you come on the show, and definitely a lot of good knowledge. So check Ken out at the Daily Economist. And you also find links to the other sites where Ken writes a lot of important articles, and especially things that are becoming more and more important that people should be aware of. So thanks again, Ken.
Thanks, Dave. Talk to you later. So know who's opposed to the dominant dark skin. Food for thought is a law for the brother man.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to take it away. We enforce it. But at the end of the day, each and every man has to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous thing.